Yeah, no, I was just trying to figure out where that was.
Which village is that?
Which map are you
looking at?
The model home.
It's the northeast village. So if you're driving north up the road, that's the first new street on your right.
Okay.
Right after the top street.
Okay.
But you're Spruce, very good.
I'm learning.
I know.
But you're actually going to start building to the left, right?
No, the right. That's the very first area. We have an overall plan. We can point right to it.
Yeah, yeah,
okay,
perfect.
Let's get going.
You know, I'm jumping the gun.
That's okay.
Okay, welcome to the Planning Board meeting for Monday, December 5th, 2016. Thank you, HCAM, for taking the meeting. As you can see, we've got four members absent at this particular point. So having the tape available will be very important. I'm hoping we get two more members coming. I know two members are not able to come. Brian Karp's father is not doing really well, and he's making some arrangements for his dad, but our prayers are with the Karp family tonight. The other thing I'd like to talk about is a little bit of the agenda. We have really kind of three public hearings that are kind of going in here. Several of them, two are actually minor site plan reviews. They will require a vote of majority vote of the members here, so you would have to get everyone's vote that was here. So the applicants might want to think whether or not they want to proceed with that at this particular time. Here comes one of our members, so you have to get all the votes. But anyway, the public hearings today, one is with the Hopkinton Pediatric Dental Association in Hayden Row for a minor site plan review. We have a public hearing for a minor site plan review for Eversource Energy on Wilson Street, which is a parking lot change. We have some minor modifications to the Legacy North villages of the improvement for approval. We have 66 Fruit Street, which is the Fruit Street Fields for an additional building that, which is probably a minor modification site plan review. We're going to have some interesting discussions, I think, on the recreational marijuana notice bylaw. We'll continue with the selectmen did in that particular area. There's also been some discussion on charter changes, which will affect how this board potentially operates. And I'd like to note that there's a charter hearing, I believe it is tomorrow night, isn't it?
Wednesday.
I think here in Town Hall, it's over at the Senior Center.
Seven o'clock, I believe.
Expecting a crowd. Yeah, good.
That's the reason for the change.
Okay. Well, it probably deserves a crowd. And I urge everyone to attend. Okay. So,
Mr. Chairman, can I just suggest that we pull that chair away for this gentleman to sit? Do you think?
Sure.
Just put it in the corner.
Yeah.
Thanks.
Yeah. Thanks. I guess we can get more chairs if we need to.
Yep.
Thanks.
I'm going to put my coat here.
Okay.
Okay, so with all of that, let's start with our 7:30 public hearing. This is an application for minor site plan review. This is the Hopkinton Pediatric Dental Association. This is an addition to their building at 79 Hayden Row Street. It's about 400 square, it's about 1,100 square feet total between the two. As the applicant can come on up and sit on the table. Please.
Can we?
Just a second. And
okay.
Basically, we have the outline for this particular hearing. We're not expected to complete it today, partly because they have to go to the ZBA to get full approval before we can grant approval, saying that it's in full conformance with the zoning bylaws. So they need a variance for that. So we're not expecting to get all the way through it, but we'd like to get it introduced make sure there's no questions that can't be answered between us, this and the next hearing. The ZBA is meeting on the
14th.
On the 14th, so then we could then meet the following week, I believe, or after that.
You could. I'm not sure that if a decision was made on the 14th, then a decision would be
posted or
finished by the 5 days later. But
okay, well, maybe,
do you know
it's,
what I mean?
Maybe it's the first week in January, procedurally wise.
Yeah, I think
I assume you're not
going to
start foundations
sense,
soon.
You never know.
You never know. Okay.
We're
okay.
Anxious to get going.
Okay. Well, anyway, we're going to be following the outline along with this. These guys have been before us at least twice in my 10 years on the board, so should be pretty easy. But this is we're following outline these days, and could you get a couple more there so that they have it? We'll start with an introduction by the applicant. Is the first thing on our outline.
Thank you.
So.
My name is Richard Brusseau. I'm the architect on the project, and Nadia Diab is here. She's the owner.
And the dentist.
And the dentist, yes, yes. That's the important part of the whole thing. Right? And we're happy to be here to present this presentation. Would you like me to do...
Why don't you give a five-minute overview?
Let me do that.
Okay.
Ken mentioned earlier, been before the board a couple of times, this lot is in a residential zone, and the building, the original building, which is this section over here, was originally a residence, and then it was a real estate company, and then the Zoning Board of Appeals at that time allowed Nadia to change the use to a dental use. In 2008, we did a fairly major addition here, which we created a better office space and waiting area, better entrance, and just better circulation altogether. Then in 2013, we added a small, another 400 square foot addition here, which created just better operatories and better space. Current additions are 400 square foot addition here and 700 square foot addition here. The parking lot right now as it exists is in here. One modification to that is a change to for a turnaround and a better location for the dumpster. 25 parking spaces, and those were going to stay.
So we're mainly doing this addition really to add waiting room space, because the waiting room is tiny, because the existing waiting room, and people are usually standing in the waiting room, or they're waiting outside the office, because there's really just no room, there's just no space to have seats for everyone to sit down.
So this is the waiting room addition here, with 400 square foot addition is primarily, it's a conference room, office, storage, and an x-ray room with a little bit better access for the doctors to access the space from the side.
And then this here is just moving the chairs around because they're so crammed together, and this is a pediatric practice. When one kid cries, the one next to him would cry, and the one next to him would cry, and then the whole office is crying, and it's so noisy. It's like you walk in and you're like, oh my god. So we're hoping by just separating the chairs a little bit, and maybe putting like sound tiles, or just to kind of absorb the sound, so we need a little space to separate them and just deafen the sound, the noise a little bit.
Once the addition, the 2016 edition is gross square footage would be 4,055 square feet. Thus, the minor site plan review.
What was that number again, please?
4,055 square feet. Gross after the addition. The building footprint is 3,062. The second floor area. From the street, from Pedro Street, is this the base of the existing pre-existing building, obviously stays the same. The addition would be in line with that. If you take a look at the site plan, this corner of the existing building is 28 feet off the property line, and this is 30. The requirement is 40. So this addition is really well further down the ZBA. It's one of the issues, obviously adding to the building. But this doesn't make the condition any worse. This is the point. This elevation is the elevation which is facing the left property, left-hand property. This is Lale's property. Currently it ends right here. This creates a new entrance to the building. This is, you know, this from here to here is all waiting room. And this is the additional operatory space. This is waiting room on the right side as you drive onto the property. This is waiting room extension. This is the operatory beyond. And this is the elevation that's closest to the street.
Any questions from the board members?
One question. In the bottom, Mr. Chairman, the paragraph, the new area shaded in, is that going to be the new addition?
Both shaded areas.
That's the 400 feet on the left. And the
right. That's for the office space on the left, and then on the right-hand side is for the waiting room.
Correct. Correct.
Gotcha.
Everyone's in water.
Okay. Okay. Why don't we go on to, Greg?
Order. My children are
clients. You better
excuse yourself. Yeah, so I guess I have to recuse myself.
I don't think so.
That's why I brought it up.
No, I don't think that's significant enough, right, Jennifer?
No, I would argue you're fine.
Are they the ones that are crying?
Are they the ones that are
No, it's Frank when he's paying the bills.
I'm helping pay for the project.
Okay, Jennifer?
I don't really have much to add. You mentioned the zoning board hearing will be on December 14th. We didn't receive any comments other than Board of Health. Had really no comments because it's served by water and sewer. Design Review Board doesn't meet until the 20th. If you feel that it needs to go to Design Review Board. I have not sent this to Beta for review. You feel like it needs Beta's review. I felt because all the changes were architectural that there was really nothing for Beta to look at. So it's your call to make.
Okay. We'll make sure we do that today before we close the hearing.
Just a quick point of order here. The Design Review Board will have two meetings this month. So tomorrow, the special meeting.
Yeah, but only for that one item.
Okay. All right. Thanks.
We'll decide whether we think this needs to go to Design Review again. I think we note that the architecture is in keeping with the rest of the architecture of the building, and you know they approved it pretty nicely, overwhelmingly the last two times. So I'm not sure whether it's worthy needs to go personally. Cliff.
Through the chair, is there going to be more parking needed for this extra 400 or 700 square feet of space?
I think that's item 4C on the list.
Yeah, but he's giving his presentation right now, so I'm just curious.
We're not adding any more chairs, really. We're just making it more comfortable for the existing. For what, as the business exists right now, we're just making it a little bit more comfortable for us and for our guests.
Sure. So okay. Thank you.
So basically, I think the answer is no, they're not expecting additional folks. Other than ones that the crying might have scared away.
I don't want you to think all our patients are crying, but we do have little kids. Yep. And this is an intimidating experience for some of them, but
yep,
we just want to make it comfortable for the moms and for the dads and for the patients.
Okay.
It's intimidating for all of us.
No, we've been working on him for years. I haven't changed that. You should have come to us when you want a child.
Okay, that we're on item.
We have a question.
I just want to point out that the addition is taking up two existing parking spaces, so you don't plan to make those two up.
No.
You can right now. You can park right along those two spots there.
We just need your name and address for the record.
Sure, Barbara Kessler at right there.
What?
81 Payton.
Thank you.
That's a very good point, and something I forgot to mention. Actually, with the addition, contact car spaces to make up that difference.
And then the parking spaces along the side of the building.
Right.
So existing parking spaces are just going to be created smaller.
Right.
So point of clarification there. Is there two parking spaces on the top that are being removed as well where the building's going?
This, actually I believe there's just one. The total is still 20.
South side entrance, it has two parking, parallel to the building, has two parking spots. Right where the addition
is
going to go.
Yeah, this is drive.
No, there's two spots there.
Well, that's where the staff parks.
Right.
Usually.
That's what I mean.
Yeah.
So,
gonna,
but you're not going to need to add.
We're not
going to
have that
to create more for those two missing ones.
No.
Do you have any issues with the full parking lot choice in front of the subject? Yes.
No.
Okay.
I mean, our patients are, at least as far as I'm aware, nobody parks in the street. Everybody parks in our parking lot, right? I mean, we haven't seen cars outside on the street.
No, I guess I was just wondering if that many spaces missing, would you need to ultimately add some more at the other end of the property that you haven't accounted for now? That was my question.
These spaces generally not your parks here.
Yeah.
It's like the web.
Where do you plan to park in the future?
No. let's get.
Probably the dumpster, close to the dumpster, I guess.
Okay, let's get back on track here. Yeah,
does that residential A fall under the 10% green space that needs to be into the? And Jen, maybe you can answer that a little bit better. They're eliminating some of the green space for the parking.
Adding.
You are adding green space, and now where are you at now?
Let's get to the details of this. We're right at the beginning of the outline. You guys are getting beyond a little bit ahead of where we're at. Let's follow the outline, Cliff, please.
Ken, listen for a second, please. You have a resident in the house that asked the question before me, and I'm bringing that up.
Okay, you can bring it up when we talk about it in the outline. You know, you've been on the board long enough that you know how the outline goes. The item we're at right now is we're adding items to the outline, and then we will, and this is kind of like a brainstorming thing, and then we will end up discussing all of these in great detail as we go down the outline. And I notice the parking lot design is 4D, which we will be getting to very shortly. Are there any and members of the public are willing to, are able to add to the outline at this point if you have any further questions on this or any other subject we have. We have traffic, we have building design, stormwater management, parking lot design, lighting, landscaping, construction management plan. What's currently on the subjects that we'll plan on talking about. Any board members have any additions?
Solar power?
Add it, but then it's an existing building.
Sure.
Okay, and anyone from the public have any additional questions, things that we need to talk about with this? Okay, so item three is shut, closed down. Now we're going to go through the detailed discussion, and we're going to spend about 15 minutes, and then we're going to kind of close the hearing, but we'll kind of touch on these in the top thing. If I go through the traffic, I believe we've heard that they're not adding any new chairs, they don't expect any additional customers, and therefore the traffic is pretty much the same, and therefore the number of parking spaces, if it was adequate before, is adequate again. But are there other questions that people have in detail about the traffic for this item? I'm seeing a consensus on the traffic, and we're going to move on and check that one off. Building design. We've got the architect here.
Excuse me, Mr. Chair.
Yep.
So I had a question when you were showing the facing. Is the outside of the building going to be the same as the existing building?
Exactly the same. Okay. Same color, same plot.
Thank you.
Okay. Let's talk about solar panels as part of building design today instead of utilities. And what's your plan? You currently have no solar panels on the building. I believe it is not necessarily a requirement that you have them per se, but we do have one board member that is very interested in at all times.
Sure.
And so,
well, I see more self-facing roofs, tops. You know, I was wondering if there's any thought behind that.
All we ask at this point is that you consider it, right?
Yeah, we cannot require that. Is there anyone here, particularly members of the board, that thinks that its design has to go to design review?
The only concern I have,
yeah, go ahead,
is the footprint's changing a bit wider, and I'm just kind of wondering how that fits into things and maybe design review.
It appears to me to be of the style of a farmhouse that's been added onto over the years again and again and again. In my opinion, the design is kind of comparable to that. So,
to be honest with you, I've only been on the board since May, and we have not had any buildings come before the board, so I don't have any experience with that. Everything we've discussed has been mostly around signage. So, I think the signage is probably staying the same.
Yeah, everything's the same.
We're consistent with what's been there. So
yep.
I agree.
Okay, so I'm going to check off building design.
Excuse me.
Yeah.
Are you saying we won't have to go to the building?
You do not have to go to design review.
Okay.
Yep. No design review required. Okay. Stormwater management. I believe the parking lot impervious surface is either roughly the same or...
Do you happen to know where the drainage is right now?
All the drainage from approximately this point back goes to the back.
Are there any catch basins or is it just running over gravel?
No catch basins, it's all chute drain.
Okay.
Drainage on this, actually there's a sort of a trench here that is the stormwater collection off this roof, off this side, and this side pitches over to stone, fresh stone here, which was the original storm drainage management before anything else was built. So this would kind of continue that. As a matter of fact, impervious material here way back in 2008. The house that's here, I believe before that, had water in the basement one time ago. So it doesn't anymore since we actually did that. I remember that as a comment way back. And it improved that situation. David, we tend to continue that.
We talked a lot about drainage at one of the earlier ones when the parking lot kind of went back a little bit. And,
sure.
And they own a lot of the land behind where the dumpster is. For
yeah, that's really
it's all wooded.
Yeah, just what I'm hearing, it doesn't sound like there's going to be any issues with drainage.
There's no more impervious material.
So basically, from a stormwater management, Jennifer made a decision not to send it to beta. The board members are concurring in that. Okay, so basically, at this point, if there's no other questions about stormwater, we'll go on from there. Okay. Let's see, we are still doing well on time. Parking lot design. The parking lot design, dumpster line, snow storage, and maybe you want to talk about, I guess you've already talked about how restriping some of the spots. Talk more about what you're doing different in the parking lot today. Make sure we got that clarified.
So the two spaces are gone.
This area too, in addition to that, this area is very heavily densely treed. Matter of fact, Mrs. Lale, the last addition, requested we didn't take any trees down, which we didn't. Subsequently, a piece of this tree broke and we asked her permission to neaten it up and take that out. Along with that, there are all these trees.
Landscaping is really staying the way it is. And the parking lot is really staying the same because it's going to have a building on it, so we're not changing that. Just adding a little more greens in here to ease the turn a little bit.
Anyone have questions on the parking lot design?
Sure, Mr. Chair.
Go ahead.
I'm just wondering the need for the compact spots. I know you're trying to maintain the same kind of number, but I always look at those as kind of tight to get in. Not the compact cars always don't park there. So, Jennifer, do they have a certain quota that they're trying to hit, do you know? Or?
No, it's just they're allowed
choice. Okay.
Up to 7.
Just a thought.
If you apply the rules for square feet for an office building or whatever the use is, how many spots do you need to have?
Why'd you tell you that?
Thank you. Right. To do the calculation.
Required parking is 12.
12?
I knew
looks
they
like
were
well beyond that.
The code is 13.
So I would just like to suggest that if there's no need for it, you could consider going with regular parking spots. Yeah, that's just a suggestion. It's entirely up to you. You obviously meet the quota, so just what you feel will satisfy your business the best.
Usually it's not too terrible to have more parking than customers coming.
Right, but it's the contact piece of it.
Yep, I understand.
Okay, just wanted to kind of that.
I thought there was a question.
I had a question, Mr. Chairman. I think it's been answered. There's enough parking spots. I just wondered how much square footage and parking is being lost with the additional. I know the parking spaces are being moved around a little bit here. There's a number of spaces that isn't really changing that much, but I just wondered, is it total motor sewer, but I think it's immaterial because there's enough parking spaces.
Right.
So that's why I kind of withdrew the question. I think it sounds like there's more than enough.
Do people think that we need to make this an action item? Because we're in about 5 minutes of closing out for today.
I'm not fine continue. With my question.
I think I'm fine.
We're fine on number of spots?
Yep.
We've got the dumpster location is pretty well spelled out. I believe it's screened, et cetera, so that's all set.
That's a bench.
And snow storage is what? Push it towards the end of?
Yeah, you push it all the way towards the end and also off to the sides.
Should be less snow removal now?
No, we don't use any
No, No, I'm just saying that there, it'll be less, by adding the building, there'll be less snow to push out the parking lot.
There was a little bit of snow.
Maybe.
Follow that.
Okay.
Unless we get 8 feet of snow.
Well, we just got one.
And, okay, so the consensus is we'll close out the parking lot design tonight, going to lighting. I don't believe I saw any extra parking lot lights or...
Lighting is off the building currently and it continues to be straight off the building. They don't typically go too far into the night working, so...
So we finish around
5,
5:30, and it's just really for us walking back so it's not so dark. And then it's on a motion sensor.
But you're not changing it at all?
No.
Okay. So Bill's basically building lighting. Consensus is, if there are no questions from anyone in the public, consider lighting done. And
that's been hit, the next thing.
Landscaping and screening, I think we've talked about that. Everyone all set on that? Anyone have any further questions on landscaping? Any abutters that particularly always used to get interested in landscaping? You're fine with it? Okay.
I heard you say that the minimum number of parking spots is 13, but what's the maximum number that a building of this size can have in a non-conforming?
There's no, we don't really set a maximum per se. It's more on people that know their business, and you know, usually if you can't find a place to park, they're not very good customers because they go somewhere else. So we don't usually minimize or maximize that.
So it's the same amount of parking that it would be if it were a business as opposed to a residential?
It shifts into
so
what category, yes.
Okay, it's the same. Yeah. Okay, thank you.
What was your question?
What category does this fit in?
This is under general office, medical, dental office, research and development, industrial uses. So there's different uses that have different requirements for parking, and so that's what this falls under. It's not really the zoning district it's in, it's the type of use of the...
Which is dictated by the zoning.
Yeah. Not, yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
Different
so,
sections.
So it's
yes, but they have a
variance
to be where they are.
Yeah.
Right. But I just wondered if there's any limit to that.
No.
Okay, got it. Thank you so much. Appreciate your help.
Just another point of clarification. There's a requirement of 3 parking spaces per 1,000 square feet.
Mm-hmm.
So
that's the requirement.
Run that number. It's 12, 13.
Minimum.
It's a minimum, yes.
Thank you very much.
There's a lot of different businesses that, while they meet the minimum, they don't meet any tenants if they only have the minimum. You know, just because you can't run the business without enough parking. So, let's see. I think we're just about where we're at. The last one, construction management plan. The board members believe that a small addition like this needs any kind of further detail on construction management, or do you like any more verbal description of how they're planning to do that?
I think it, for me, it's spelled out pretty good.
Okay.
But that's my opinion. Yeah. I don't know about the rest of the board.
They've successfully done through the remodeling twice without losing any customers, so I think they'll take care of it, and it's... Most of that is off the street, so I don't expect to see any mud out in the street. We will condition those like we always have done. So, okay. At this point, we've gotten through 1 through 4 of the agenda. We could not, and we will start up with more public comment and discuss the site plan standards and if there's any plan revisions that are needed. So far, we've identified, I think, no issues that are outstanding, other than getting a ZBA approval for the non-conforming issues on it. So I think at this point, you know, we're looking pretty good from an approval standpoint. That's the nod that I'm at. We're just kind of waiting for the ZBA. Jennifer will be writing up conditions. I suggest that you...
Yes, I think I did.
You already did. It's in her memo. And also in her memo, she took a stab of site plan standards and how we meet on that. And if you guys, applicant, would review that for the next meeting. It'll make it go faster, and maybe we can get the rest of this thing done in a very short period of time. Now, Jennifer, what's the date that you recommend that we continue the public hearing to?
Our first meeting in January is January 9th. I mean, it's up to you if you want to try it for the 19th of December. I just think that's a pretty short time frame from the 14th.
CBA typically does not write up a decision in 4 days. There's a few times we write up decisions in 4 days, but that's even exceptional, I think. Mm-hmm. So we're looking at the 9th of January. Okay.
And we're out till the 23rd.
Do you want to do it to the 23rd then? 23rd of January? Okay. 8:30. I'll entertain a motion to continue the public hearing to January 23rd
motion.
At 8:30. Moved.
Seconded.
Further discussion? Seeing none, how do you vote?
Aye.
Aye. Anyone opposed? Anyone abstain? Motion carries. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
And we look forward to seeing you in January, and hopefully we're not under 3 feet of snow that day, but other than that.
Let's hope.
Okay, so let's see. Now we're on to our second public hearing of the night, which will be a public hearing, minor site plan review, Eversource Energy, 52 Wilson Street. And
Come on
in here.
Okay.
And
come on down.
Let me
John,
you
wanna
yes. Okay. And you kind of sat through the last one. You understand? We have an outline for you guys too to make it. That's just to keep me on track.
Very good. Thank you.
Let's see. We are missing just two members tonight. It's a minor site plan review. We only need a majority vote of 5. I recommend that we keep going, but it's your decision, given we have a couple members missing. But if we don't get through it tonight for any reason, they can watch a tape and vote on it at the next meeting, so you don't necessarily lose anything if you've got that. But assuming if you want to go ahead, because that's why you're here.
Yes.
Okay, we'll start following the outline for 52 Wilson Street. And why don't you introduce yourselves, introduce the project, kind of talk about it a little bit, and give us a 5-minute overview or 10 minutes, whatever it takes to kind of explain it, and then we'll go through.
Does the board have?
We have
drawings?
All the information
okay.
that you, mm-hmm. you,
all right,
you provided.
Good. And I have some supplemental additional information
okay.
that maybe I can. I don't have enough copies for everyone, but I think.
We can pass around.
Possibly
I can
pass these around because I think these will answer many of the questions that are on your agenda.
Okay.
So I think that might help out.
Okay.
And then I also have some pictures of the site. I think visually it makes it a little easier. So my name is Jim Blackburn. I am a project manager with Eversource with the Liquefied Natural Gas Group. So I handle all the capital projects in Connecticut and Massachusetts for our company. We are here today to propose to you the expansion of Hawkington, our Wilson Street plant's parking area. So the existing facility has a parking area for 11 spaces today? Or no,
I think that's right.
15. I have it in here.
11.
Oh, we have 11, and I think we're adding, we'll be up to...
Currently it's 18.
18, and we'll be adding 11.
Yeah.
We have an area, and this actually is probably the time to pass these around. You'll be able to see, pass a couple copies in that direction. And then this is a staple copy, but essentially our existing parking area is from the plant when the plant was built in 1967. Since that time, there's been a lot of changes to the facility as far as the operations of the facility. We no longer allow cars to park inside the fence line. So since the fence has been established, we now limit all the parking outside the fence line. With that, over the years, we have really outgrown that parking area. So you'll see right now this area here is where our existing cars park. We have 15 full-time employees at the facility during the day, and we outgrow that every single day very quickly. Anytime you bring a couple folks on site for tours or anything else, we quickly utilize all that space, and then we end up having to overflow to the other side of Wilson Street down by our tank farm area. That causes issues. Folks have to walk across the street. There's no sidewalk on Wilson Street. It's somewhat dangerous crossing that area, and really the facility needs to upgrade that parking area just to make it more convenient for everyone working there and a little safer.
I'm sorry, I didn't understand one thing you said about parking inside. No longer allowed to park inside the fenced area?
That's correct. So when you look at this picture,
yes.
You'll see that the existing parking area has a fence here.
Yes.
And then there's a fence that goes around the facility.
Yes.
Currently, during the initial, when the plant was originally built, there was no fence line. You could come right freely into the facility. Okay. Since then, obviously, we've put that fence line up. We no longer allow cars to park inside the fence line, so none of our employees park inside the fence line. We're very limited. There's a little bit more security involved. They have to mirror the vehicles and such. So we really don't encourage that. I mean, it's very common practice for Eversource, even at our service stations, but we don't. It encourages theft and other things. So we certainly keep all of our parking typically outside the fence line, and we do that at this facility also.
I don't get it. Is that parking lot inside the fence area or outside the fence?
There's two fences. I'm sorry. Yeah. There's two fences. There's a outside fence for the parking area.
The big fence.
Then there's an inner fence for the facility itself. We don't allow parking on the inside fence any longer.
Oh, okay.
So we park all the cars inside of the outside fence.
Inside of the inside.
Inside of the outside fence, we allow parking. We park our vehicles. The inside fence, we prefer vehicles not to cross.
Okay. So with the amount of space that you're asking for, and the reason you put the fence up in the first place was to stop people from coming in further, right?
Security, yes.
Security.
Yep.
So this gets closer to the tanks from what I see?
Yes. Those two tanks are firewater storage tanks.
Okay.
So those are you know, those are not LNG storage tanks or any flammable gas or anything like that.
All right. And
the inner fence will change.
But I see the overlap on a building that you have here. Is that a building?
No, it's not. That's actually a one of those portable water tanks that you would use, a frac tank.
Okay.
So that's that doesn't exist. That currently is not there. That was a temporary. I don't know if that was for some work. Yeah, that's photos from a couple years ago. So that's like a portable water tank, like a rain for rent.
Is there anything in its place now?
There isn't. So this proposed area currently is just gravel. It's just stone right now.
I see.
And so what we proposed, and originally when we looked at this, we proposed moving to the west, which would be into this tree line area. Instead, because we already had that gravel area, it was already disturbed, it's very easy for us just to move that fence in, and now we'll pave that area. But we won't be disturbing any of the existing vegetation that's on the west side of the existing fence line.
And just as a follow-up, is it a point of your opinion that this is a safety thing as well? Does it fall under a safety, people evacuating if there were a situation or anything like that? Does that impede that?
I don't think this certainly doesn't impede that. What I would say from a safety perspective, I do think it helps with us as we bring vehicles in and out of there. Currently, the parking is so tight, we often double park.
Mm-hmm.
And so by doing so, we impede folks coming in and out of there.
Yeah.
Oftentimes, if you have a delivery from, say, UPS, that vehicle will park in the driveway as we screen the vehicle before bringing it in.
Mm-hmm.
That makes it difficult for somebody else to leave.
Sure.
In this new design, we would have basically a waiting lane where the UPS truck or another delivery could pull off to the side and still leave unimpeded access in and out of the facility. So that would be certainly an upgrade to what we're doing with this design.
Let's continue to keep it at the high level at the beginning, and then we'll get into the...
There's something you said earlier I just wanted clarification on. Mm-hmm. You said something about decrease in theft. I'm not sure.
We don't have, I mean, with the amount of security that we have at the facility, we don't have that issue here, but like at our service centers, we have stock rooms and other stuff. You don't want. We often try to separate the company's vehicles from personal vehicles. That's how rolls of tape and every other little item like that go home with the employees. So that's what I mean by that. We don't necessarily have that issue at this facility, but in our service centers throughout the state, we try to limit access between vehicles and company property.
So. And the company vehicles are in this second fence?
Right now, we do allow vehicles into the second fence for activities inside the plant, but we try to limit that. So vehicles that go through the fence need to be screened additionally by security.
The company trucks and employee vehicles are inside the first fence, not the second fence.
We only have...
What, just to expand on it, there's a double secure gate system. You have to pull up to the first gate, hit the button, talk to the guard. He lets you in the first gate. That closes behind you. There's another gate in front of you, so you can't drive into the plant that way. If you need to go in the plant, you'll pull up, and he'll put the mirror under your chassis like they do at airports and other places. By mirroring the vehicle, and then they'll, once they're inspected and they're checked in, they're given a pass, then they can go in the plant. If you're just a visitor, you'll go in, you'll park in this parking area off to the side, walk up to the guard shack and walk into the plant and leave your vehicle there. So that's how they're kind of segregating and controlling access. You can come in the first one. It's kind of like going to prison. You go in the first gate and they close it behind you, and you can't go forward or backwards until they figure out who you are, what you are, inspected, checked in, badged, safety briefed.
We only have one company vehicle on the site, so that's the only vehicle that really goes to that second gate.
Okay.
Unless we have construction activities or something else, we'll let them in as needed, but we try to limit it just because efficiency of having to check each vehicle, it just takes time out of the day of everyone.
Just a quick question.
Go ahead.
For Eversource as well?
I work for AECOM. I'm AECOM, a design engineer, consultant engineer, project manager. So I work for Genoa.
Yeah, so Eversource has brought with them AECOM, who's our engineer. They did all the design plans for this project. The plant operator, so who actually operates the plant, is Air Products and Chemicals. So Danielle is here to represent the plant operators also.
And
Kathy is also with AECOM.
Okay, so if they're needed, they can come. Okay, I think we've got a pretty good introduction. This is a relatively minor change to a parking lot.
Mm-hmm.
Jennifer, go ahead.
Again, I don't really have much for this. Again, it's, in my opinion, a minor change. I did not think this needed design review because there's no design for the design review board to review. I did not fully set it to beta, but I did email the plans to beta just and ask them to... about the stormwater and if they were at all concerned about adding a pavement for 11 spaces over the gravel, if that was going to affect the stormwater at all. I heard back verbally from Phil, nothing in writing because it wasn't official, that he was comfortable with the design. He didn't really have any issues with how everything was laid out. He didn't think the stormwater was going to be impacted by the small change of pavement, so he was satisfied with that. But if the board wants something more formal, the only town department, again, that we heard from was Board of Health, and they had no comments.
Okay, so I think unless there's further questions to Jennifer, we're through the first two items on our outline. Okay, now we get to the point where we can add to the outline if we need it. Now, we're talking about a parking lot. We already have traffic, stormwater management, parking lot design, which includes snow storage, handicap parking, lighting. That's all we put in the preliminary outline. If anyone has any good ideas to add to it, now's the time. If not, we will continue on. The public is more than welcome to add, as well as members of the board. Okay, seeing...
To the chair then?
Yep.
You had mentioned that Wilson Street is a very treacherous street to cross. Is there a possibility that can be looked at for you as a...
Yeah, honestly, we had approached, and I don't recall who it was with the town. I thought it was the DPW about adding a crosswalk there.
Yeah, Rich talked to the DPW, I think it was, but because there's no, I think all we can do is
a yield. We could add was it a yield sign or a slow sign?
Slow sign.
But because there's no sidewalks there and there's no room for the sidewalks, and the way our property is, we have basically two driveways on either side, and they're kind of diagonal from each other. fairly significantly. We had originally asked if we could do like a crosswalk, and he said it wouldn't have met. I don't know if that's
sounds like
what guidelines
have a crosswalk without sidewalks, right?
That's right. So we had kind of gone. I'd love to further that, but it seemed as though we'd kind of hit an impasse with that.
If I may,
go ahead.
Through David, through the chair, Dave, have we thought about sidewalk over on Wilson? Yes, right. I think we remember.
Hasn't been brought up yet.
Has not been brought up, and it is a scenic road, and you know there's not been a lot of demand, and quite frankly, I mean we're going to be seeing a lot more sidewalk traffic on, I'll say, Rafferty / Legacy North, which is now has a sidewalk for it. I mean, I don't think we're trying to encourage foot traffic in front of the plant.
No, but again, my concern is the safety, like you had brought up yourself. And if we're already working on sidewalks in that area, I'm just trying to not.
We're not. That's so far down anyone's list. I don't think that it.
Okay.
The other part of that is we've got Jim and Crowd gave us a tour of the facility. Jen and I and Elaine Norman and the chief and zoning. Building inspectors all got a tour inside the facility, seemed like about a month ago, I believe.
Yep.
And, you know, if I remember correctly, the site distance right where those driveways are is pretty good. Elsewhere,
it's probably one of the few straightaways on Wilson Street.
Yeah.
And it's wide open, no trees, right? Not many.
That's right.
Right. So it's not, it's one where you should see them coming at this point.
And I will say, we do get creative with our existing parking lot to avoid putting folks on the other side of the road because it is an issue, especially if it snows.
Mm-hmm.
Now you have to kind of walk up through that snow. It's more of a falling, slip trip kind of hazard,
right,
than really anything. But we do try to avoid crossing that street with pedestrians.
And just as a follow-up, the reason why I say this is because Legacy North is a big project that's going to take some time to develop. But once it is, there's going to be more and more traffic going down Wilson and throughout the area and all of that, and so we need to look forward a little bit to make sure that we're dialing it in now rather than later. Is my idea anyway.
We're trying our best on the design at Wilson Street to keep the traffic off of Wilson Street. That's why the Rafferty Road intersection is, and we've also asked for four-way stop sign, if you remind the board,
right,
up at the Rafferty / Wilson Street intersection, actually it'll be Legacy North. So the selectmen are considering that, and they've sent it off to one of the their consultants to get their opinion on that.
I know we don't want to spend a lot of time on this, but Cliff brings up a good point. I think maybe the over want to walk through the downtown area, and they would take Wilson Street, so maybe we can consider that with our sidewalk approach.
I would kind of disagree with that because the slope coming down Wilson,
yeah,
from there, senior people aren't going to do that.
But then somebody wants to walk downtown.
I'm telling
you,
I run it all the time, and it's just not going to be feasible, and it's a scenic road.
Okay.
All right, but if I may add to that,
I don't think we need
friends. Just saying, I'm over 55 years old. I can walk down that street very, very easily. So whether or not, that's what we're calling senior, is 55 and over.
Let's address that, guys.
I think this is far afield of where we're at on the parking lot.
I agree.
So let's.
I have a comment specific to this. I think that the walking access is for the, in this area, for the employees of NSTAR, Eversource, and I've heard that there's been some difficulties because of the situation, but if there's any ways for Eversource to provide a sidewalk for your employees, I think we'd be willing to work with that. But
I think, Frank, you make a good point, even if you wanted to connect the driveway on a portion of the street. You know, if you want to do something on Wilson Street, we'll be happy to talk about it.
I think probably not as part of this project, but as you're aware, we have other intentions of the facility.
Yeah.
And I think we would absolutely consider that. I think it would benefit probably both of us in the end.
We can always invite DPW to attend the meeting as well if you want to move forward.
Okay. And that's all I was trying to say, folks. Sure. Okay. Was to add to that aspect.
Okay. Any additions to the outline? Seeing none, let's move on. We're on to traffic for detailed discussions. No new employees for this change. It's just really to accommodate where you're at. That's what I heard.
That's correct. In fact, I would say we may, with our kind of queue area that we have where vehicles can kind of pull up, where we had backups into the driveway that goes up there, we'll be able to make sure everyone's up into the kind of the gated area. So not that we back up ever out onto the street, but at least it'll reduce, you know, a vehicle coming around the corner, you know, having to kind of slow on the brakes a little bit, making that turn. That'll be a clear and free area, so we should have zero impact on the traffic in that area.
I mean, when they start doing construction on the other side, there's going to be temporary traffic of more significant, but, you know, we also now have, or will have, Legacy North, which puts a throughway that makes it easier for everyone to get to that site, quite frankly. So anyway, I'm not seeing anything on a traffic issue that the planning board should be concerned about. Should we close that one off? Okay, I'm seeing a bunch of nods, yes. Stormwater management, I think we've hit most of that already with Jennifer reaching out to Phil, our peer review engineer, and there was no concerns there. He's got no concerns. Brent?
One question, Mr. Chairman. Is this area going to be paved, or is it
It will be paved. We will be leaving the gravel on the outer boundary of it. And so talking with our environmental folks, we will have plenty of rock in there to reduce erosion and allow for percolation.
It slopes a little bit, doesn't it?
There is a slight slope there, yes, and we'll be maintaining the existing slope.
Further questions on stormwater? Seeing none, let's close that one off. Parking lot design, why don't you kind of take us through one of your plans for that?
Could
you
maybe? Yes. So John's going to grab a copy of the larger plans.
Mm-hmm. We'll stand around it. We'll open ours.
I wish I had previously been to one of those, because I actually really like the foam board. I made it a little easier.
One of these days, we'll get this next room one, right? such that we can use some electronic stuff.
Yeah, I do actually have them saved on my computer, just in case the laptop was an option, but yeah. I know the other room, I think we had the opportunity. But
let me use the striping plan rather than the site plan.
Yeah, sure.
Because of the scale difference.
That's okay. I think everyone can kind of look up. Or
they could stand up if they want to see.
Okay.
Right, guys?
Yeah.
just orientate yourself. I'm standing in Wilson Street. There's the woods in Wilson Street. Here's the driveway that comes up to the plant. This is the guard shack. And this is the first gate and the second gate. So as you're coming up the driveway, you're going to come in here, and you're going to have a decision point whether you're going to... You stopped here. You buzzed. The guard has let you in now. He knows who you are. You come in. You are either going to come over here and park in one of these spots here. The circulation is kind of in this direction here. And this is both an in and out entrance to this. And this is all striping. There's no barricades here. So when they plow snow, they'll get a free and clear. This is the receiving lane that Jim referred to, where UPS, FedEx, etc., and other deliveries will come up. And they'll pull off to the side here, out of the way of the gate, where right now they pretty much have to stop right in front of the gate. If there's somebody waiting to come out, then they have to kind of play cat and mouse to get in and out. So this guy can pull over in the receiving lane and wait. If the guards are busy, they can come out and they can mirror his vehicle here off to the side, and vehicles are clear to go in and out. And these vehicles are also clear to get in and out of the parking lot as needed. They can't really get out. They can pull up to the gate and wait. Same thing on this side. This is all controlled movements by the gates here and the decision point in this parking spot here. As you can see, we've got, you know, nicely striped pedestrian areas so that we'll keep traffic and pedestrians separated even more so than what's existing there now. Coming out of the guard shack building, coming over, and the pedestrian gate to the plant is right here. So the people that park here get a pass. They walk back across here. They swipe their card on a little reader there, and then they can walk in to the plant that way. So it keeps the pedestrian traffic separate in designated areas from any other traffic that's going on, either parking or deliveries or exiting vehicles. So that was kind of the layout. Right now, this is very congested, and cars are kind of parked every which way.
Yeah.
There aren't a lot of designated pedestrian areas. There is no designated receiving lane, again, because this is so tight. It's pretty much kind of a, I mean, they do have width here, but, you know, the FedEx truck's a little wide, so it kind of chokes it down. So, but this will significantly improve their flow.
Do the FedEx trucks normally unload inside the second gate?
What's this going around the parking lot? How is it being bordered in?
Currently, there's jersey barriers all the way around in front of the fence,
okay.
So that when you pull up, you don't go a little too far
sure.
And hit the
yep.
fence.
Or so
you're plowing
snow, extend those.
That kind of thing. So what we're doing is, these are actually existing barriers. We're only actually purchasing 8 or 10 new barriers to kind of fill out the perimeter from there, pushing it out to here, and filling in the corner. So they're just standard MassDOT.
So I just add one more. This is my big question. Why did you design it as a weird shape and just instead of a normal parking lot coming down here? Because this is kind of crazy over here.
Right. Well, and that, again, became the preferences of the plant more than anything else. There's poles here that kind of tie us in. There's a hydrant here and some stuff, so they wanted to keep clearance so they can drive down here and do the hydrant test every year. There's some side slopes going on here because
okay.
It's flush here,
so
but the parking lot is
limited at this end.
Right, so there's some grading going on that's coming down here. So the toe of that slope to the hydrant, we had
sure.
to keep a space
sure.
there.
Sounds like all valid reasons.
Thanks. Right, they had to maximize it. This is kind of the existing line of the lot now that comes out there, so we kind of extended that line. And so it didn't make sense to make this corner here connect, so
yep.
we just kind of cut the corner off and striped it off. Save that work and allows more space for the grading to taper it out and blend in.
Yeah, no, I was just looking at this open area here, but it sounds
right.
like they need to get by there.
Correct.
The
they've got to walk
sure,
here, and they do need to be able to get a maintenance vehicle down in
sure.
here, down into this area here as well. And there's the pipe racks that go around the side of the plant, so they need to get down in there to.
So hopefully, these two cars won't be backing out at the same time there.
Right, yeah, it's like almost any parking lot. And
yes.
Like Jim said, you know, a lot of these cars, they show up, they're there for the whole day.
Right, right.
It's not
it's
an in-and-out type of...
It's a private parking lot, basically.
Yeah, it's not a bank where you're in for 5 minutes and you're out.
Right.
People come and they stay. And it's not a frequent use movement.
Are you doing construction on the original parking lot as well?
Yes, the original parking lot pavement is distressed and cracked. There's a couple of old concrete foundations that are kind of flush there. So those will be removed. And the existing pavement will get a 1-inch mill and overlay, so that, and then the whole thing will get the wearing course will be continuous, so it'll look like a new parking lot all the way across.
Is there any question on why that pad, that concrete 12-inch thick pad that's in the middle of the existing parking lot, what is that there for?
Well, that was, again, the original plant gate, and they've changed these gates over the years. 67, mm-hmm. And I think it was in the 70s, late 70s or something like that. They
yeah.
built the second gate. They moved the gate fence.
It was later than that.
Even later.
Can you just point to what you're referring to right now?
Well, you don't see
it
on this plan.
Just point to where it is. That's all.
It's right in this area.
Oh, right in that area.
Yeah,
okay.
It's right in this area here. It was an old foundation for
okay.
I forget what it was, but
sure.
When they went to the two gate scenario and put this fence in, they moved this gate back and redid everything. They just kind of left it. They were able to roll over.
All right, just because it was 12 inches thick, I was wondering why that. I mean, that's pretty thick.
Right. It was there for an old tank or something that was there when this was in
there?
The plant. No, right now you drive over this in the driving area or whatever. But they left it there because it was cheaper to leave it there than to take it out, apparently. So we're going to take it out.
I see.
We're going to put sub base in, and we're going to make this, you know, all nice bituminous pavement from end to end.
Okay, so let's try and get down the outline here. So snow storage?
Snow storage is obviously some areas here we can store snow on a day like today where we get a few inches or whatever, they can push it over there. As the winter goes on and the piles get bigger, these spots in the corners will get utilized for the larger snow piles, so they'll probably use a couple of the spots on a short-term basis, and then they can come in with their front-end loader and remove the snow and put it in other areas of the plant. Right now they pile snow right in this area here as well, from this paved area. So as they need the space, they can then open it up and just add to the pile.
And they have their own front-end loader?
Yes, we do.
Okay. Questions? Any further questions on the parking lot, per se?
Yes, I do.
Go ahead.
Is there any landscaping being added, trees?
Yeah, so...
we're just trying to check.
On the...
I don't know. We have updated this drawing to reflect, I think, the landscaping.
Doesn't have to be a lot of detail. I just wondered if you had some spots where you're putting some trees in.
Yeah.
Just even point to them. I don't need to.
Well, we didn't put trees in the original submittal. There's an existing landscaping area there now that's mulch and some plantings. We were going to freshen that up and add a few more plants and that kind of thing. So. In this particular version, we've kind of darkened it in and showed how we're going to make the planting area bigger along the driveway where you first come in before you get to the guard track. And we've also shown a couple of precast concrete planters that are about 42 inches in diameter and 30 inches high that they're going to have some plantings in there that they can move. They'll be able to pick them up with a forklift and move them out of the way so that when they do snow removal and that kind of thing.
Yeah,
they can move these things.
Yeah, I was all excited because I saw those spots. I'm like, hey, let's put some trees there. But once you said you need it for snow removal, it's kind of like.
Well, we're also very sensitive to trees up against the fence.
Right.
In fact, it's a federal requirement of us to keep trimmings back. So we are,
right.
We recognize that you want to see some
sure.
landscaping to it. So we try to keep some lower cover, but without getting trees up against the fence or blocking
fine
view.
With your design. Thank you.
I think it.
Yeah.
This parking lot is pretty remote from the from the Wilson Street, so it's tough to see.
We had talked about the handicap signage. So
and we have updated on this drawing, which we'll be able to leave with you, and it's stamped and signed.
And we've got one handicap spot, and I assume that's more than adequate for the rest.
Just one for 25 spaces.
Okay, so we're set for there. Does anyone else have any questions on parking lot design? Seeing none, are you doing anything different on the lighting? I mean, not that this is not a unlit site as it is.
We are not, but we did take it into consideration. We had Air Products do a survey in the area with their photo
light meter,
and the readings came back more than adequate for the facility, and we don't intend on adding any additional lighting.
Any further questions? I think we're through the detailed. Any public comment? I think we're through the detailed
Actually,
discussion.
I have a question.
Go ahead.
And it's more of a planning board type of question. Where they're not adding lighting, is that something that is listed as a condition that the plan, we're noting that the plan is not adding lighting? Or?
I think at this point they're covered on lighting and all sorts of other safety aspects that I would suggest that we just be quiet on that entirely.
Sure.
I mean, they have
no need to mention what they're not doing.
Gotcha.
Right.
The existing lights are on the existing condition plan, so
and they don't have anyone really close in the backyard at that for that
right
and other reasons. Well, even later on, there is still a fairly
Lanterns.
Okay.
Thank you.
Okay, I think we're down to discussion of the in the public is invited to weigh in with us to discuss site plan standards and plan revisions. I believe we have the plan revisions already done. Is what
you
they
can
say.
Leave one with me, then we do.
Okay, and basically we have in Jennifer's memo, we have page 5, we have the votes we have to do, and we do the site plan, her opinion on site plan standard compliance. the board members have looked through there. I think everything is complied or not applicable. I don't think there was any that we had a problem with. The board members agree with that? The public members agree with that? If not, we'll need some further discussion.
I would agree with that, Mr. Chairman. I agree as well.
I agree with it.
Okay, so I'm seeing a consensus that we're finding that the site plan vote area or that it will comply. And then conditions, the next item, which is item 6 on the agenda, which we're moving right along, which is good. We're talking about the conditions of approval. Conditions of approval that we talk about start on the page at top of page 8. First condition is, in the event that the amount of snow on the site exceeds the amount that can be accommodated safely, it's going to be removed. That's something we typically put in just about everyone. You've got a place to move it to. You've got a pretty big site, so that shouldn't be a problem because that's what you're doing already. Mitigating all construction impacts, including erosion, siltation, dust control. Remove any construction debris from the site, and you won't bury any trees, but I don't even think you have any trees in that. This has got relatively small demolition stuff. Basically, the Director of Municipal Inspection will inspect it for compliance. If he needs a professional engineer to help him on that, it's going to be on your dime. Typically do a $5,000 bond. Really, that's in case erosion or something ended up in the street and we had to pay to clean it up. Mm-hmm. You'll get that right back as soon as you're done with the project, and just remember to
Ask for it.
It's
a good policy.
You know, I mean, it's, yeah. But once you ask for it and you've got compliance or a sign off, you're all set. And the last one is that we our construction is those hours, which is under a town bylaw, which allows you to work 7 days or 6 days of the week. Except for holidays. We don't have the holidays in that, do we?
It's word for word from the bylaw.
Really? Okay.
I think. I'll double check.
Well, we don't allow you to work on holidays either.
That's all right.
Doing everybody a favor.
Yeah. So anyway, did you have a problem with those particular conditions?
Absolutely not.
Okay. So now we're in the last phase, public comment. Anyone have any further things to say? Because I think I see everyone here for something else other than this one, so I've seen none. And now we're down to the vote aspect. We have three different votes. One is a vote to determine that the project meets the requirements of a minor project under zoning 210-134. Consider it a motion. Motion moved.
Second.
Further discussion.
I concur.
Seeing none. How do you vote? Aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Anyone abstain? Motion carries. Okay. Now the next is a vote to determine that the plan complies with the site standards with conditions that will be voted on. We'll do that. We'll do three votes. So basically, this is a motion to determine that the plan complies with the site standards with conditions.
So moved.
Moved and seconded. Further discussion? Seeing none, how do you vote?
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Anyone abstain? Motion carries. And the last is to entertain a motion to approve the site plan with the new pages that we've got with the conditions.
Six.
1 through 6 listed on page 8 of Jen's memo.
So moved.
Moved and second. Further discussions.
Discussion.
Yep.
I think that I'd be happy to vote on this, but I have other concerns, and I know that there's many projects and EverSource is a big company, but we have some issues that are unaddressed in our town by EverSource that I don't feel comfortable voting on this until maybe we have some answers that you can help us with in regards to telephone utility poles.
This is the gas side, so these guys hardly know anything about it. But what I will do, because because I share a lot of your concerns on some of those. Let's finish this, and then they will be here for five more minutes, and they will listen to us vent a little bit.
I will be more than happy to take any details you have to that, because that comes up any time I come in here, and it's never any of our work. And I take that, I always go back with that comment to the folks.
Well, you've been straightforward with us before, but I just think that if we withhold voting on this, at least until we get some answers, I know it's different divisions, but it's the same company, and we're the same town, and we haven't had any redress on a lot of issues since last time we've seen you. Not that it's your responsibility.
I agree with you, Frank. I just don't think it's fair to these guys doing this project completely separate. So I would like to follow Ken's suggestion and just speak to him after the meeting.
He makes a very good point, though.
Yeah, no, we all agree
with
that.
We're going to have fun venting for about 5 minutes, okay?
Is the public involved in that?
Well, we will just keep it. We'll keep it to ourselves on that one for a while. But okay, so basically, we have a motion before us to approve it with conditions.
So moved.
Motion
and a second.
Is there further discussion?
I want to take another bite at the apple.
Yeah, okay.
I have seen no problem delaying this project, voting on this project until we get some more company. And yeah, these guys are different, but it's the same company, and we have utility poles that are twinned up, and there's a lot of serious questions we have that haven't been resolved. And I think if these guys say, well, you know what, this town really needs to have these problems addressed, and they're willing to work with us, but your side of the company isn't giving us any information or anything to work with, we really need to get these things resolved to help this town. And I think being a good corporate citizen means that a company resolves issues before they move on with other issues.
I think we're ready for a vote. All those in favor of approval with conditions, 1 through 6, say aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed?
I'm abstaining.
And one abstention? Okay. See, that gives you enough to prove, so it has been approved. The final vote is to close the public hearing. And it's a motion.
Second.
Moved and seconded. Further discussion? Seeing none, how do you vote?
Aye.
Aye. Anyone opposed? Anyone abstained? Motion carries. Okay, now we're into the venting mode. Congratulations, you're approved.
Thank you very much.
We will write this description up, or the approval up, probably within the next week. And then from there on, you're ready to go.
As you, before you start chewing me out, as you are aware, we do have a lot of other work, and so this facility is extremely important to the company. And I have an audience with the COO at least every month, and I will make sure that point that you make, that there is other work that the utility does in the town that affects, you know, the perception of what takes place at the facility. So you certainly are not going unheard, at least from my perspective, because obviously,
right,
you know, I'm very interested in what my work, you know, takes place based on other folks's, you know.
And you can let him or her know that it came up as part of your project.
Absolutely. And he's very interested in my projects and
right,
will not
right,
be happy to hear about the other work potentially affecting him.
So if I can vent a little on that.
Time out.
Why do I get stopped every time?
Well, I just said, you have any details of what you're venting about.
Time out. Let me try take the first step at venting, and then we all don't have to say it, because I want to get out of here at 10 o'clock, and we got a lot of stuff left to do. First of all, we have an issue of poles not being moved, which has hurt every developer that's also in this room. You know, we don't even have power connected. I think it's going on 18 months on Legacy North. You know, not Wilson Street, but right around the corner from your facility on Franklin Road, those power hasn't been connected up through the through road. And quite frankly, getting the power from there is also going to help your reliability too. But it's been 18 months since the developer of Legacy North paid the electric guys to put the power in. And, you know, it's taken forever. And we all last winter we had poles on Franklin in the middle of the road. They finally got moved. It took 8 months of a pole right in the middle of the road. And we have that the winter before, we had another intersection that we're doing. So getting poles moved is impossible.
These are ones that are in storage on the side of the road. Are we talking about poles that poles are in the middle?
We moved the road. We put a turning lane in. And to get a pole done out of there, I mean, towns ought to get some priority. Our DPW, for a while, they couldn't even... We had to demobilize a contractor that was doing work on there because we couldn't get a pole added and serviced to the facility. To me, that's just outrageous. You wouldn't put it up on your facility, you know, if you were building it. And, you know, it's just... So there's the new construction standpoint. And I'm not even talking about the double poles. They haven't touched a double pole, I don't think, in, it seemed like, years in this town.
Do you think we can give them a list of double poles, though, instead of just saying we have all these double poles? They
know where they all are. Okay. They have to have this board is working with the legislature to try to work on a law. Now, whether we get it through DPU or not, to try to address these issues. We're to the point where we're frustrated enough that we're talking to the local legislature, and that's one of our goals for this year. So you might get something with the people that have some clout coming at. And, you know, that's greatly concerning. The other issue that this town is very concerned, which appropriate to your facility, and I didn't want to bring it up in the context of the hearing, we did a gas study with a potential leak where the pipe goes under the Wilson Street, and the town is very interested in improving the barrier to a lot so that somebody couldn't accidentally drive off and sever your lines there. And, you know, even though it's a scenic road, we, the planning board, will work with you and the fire chief and anyone else. That, to me, is unfortunately got identified as a public safety route. The document's in the public domain. And quite frankly, if that happened after all we talked about on that to me is just I don't know how people would sleep with themselves with that.
Can I comment to that one? And I think it was in the process when you had visited the facility, but since then we have made some changes on one side to help address that. And we have future ambitions there to do more.
That's one that we share your concerns with that, and we just don't want anything. You know, we truly want this to be the safest facility that's around. Okay, now, are there anyone else have anything beyond that wants to vent that needs to amplify? We got all the poll issues, et cetera.
Just the point I made that if we can get the details wherever possible, that always helps.
Anyone that wants to go make a list of where the double polls are, you know, let's have at it. But
the only thing I'd like to add is that people make phone calls all the time, and they complain to EverSource about issues, and they don't get addressed. And again, it's to Ken's point that months and months and months go by, and we're your hometown. Mm-hmm. For everything that you're doing, and we appreciate you being a business in our area and what you do, but we have residents that are very concerned about issues, and when they make phone calls and nothing ever gets done, it comes back and looks ugly on the town, and so then we're back at you guys.
Okay. Oh, and I had one more that I probably should add to the list. If the DPW manager was here, he would say the best indication of when EverSource needs to put a new gas main in or rehab a gas main is the year after we just repaved the road.
Understood. Understood.
Yeah, and you know, we had a couple of those in the last two winters too.
And what about the feasibility of gas lanterns surrounding the entire facility versus just Legacy North?
Why don't we talk about that offline? Okay.
But it is a concern, and I share.
Yep. We can talk about that one offline. I think you're aware of what we're talking about.
Understood.
Okay. thank you very much. Thank you for sticking for the venting.
Thank you very much.
And, thank you.
If there's anything more,
I chuckle a little bit because I asked for a pole to be moved a week ago.
And no,
it's not. The response I got, I was extremely upset with.
I hope they put you in the same line.
I thought there was some love between folks within the company, and there certainly was not. Thank you very much. I appreciate it.
Now that you're going to be the CEO, you go in and
good luck with the partner. It gives me another reason to push all of that along.
Okay.
Good luck, guys, with the partner.
Thank you very much. Appreciate you all listening.
Okay, let's next business. Legacy North modifications to site plan review. Mark, I think I saw you there hiding there.
I'm here, yeah.
Come on up.
Hey, Mark.
How you doing?
Okay.
Mark on those seats.
Okay. In my opinion, these are all relatively minor items, but we're going to take them one at a time. The changes. I'm first going to start off with the sewer line for the northeast village for the model home areas.
Okay, Mr. Chairman.
Yep.
If would you like me to? I can go as fast or as slow as the board.
Well, why don't you quickly explain it and
okay.
Go fairly fast? Because I think what was in the package was fairly self-explanatory.
Great.
But if there are any questions on it, we'll do them one at a time, so that. They can each be.
Would you like me to start with the model park?
Start with the sewer line.
Okay.
Because that's what you want to build first.
That is. Thank you, board members. For the record, Mark Mastriani. I'm here with Reed Blue. We're from Pulte Homes. We're the applicants of Legacy Farms North. We recently all approved a site plan approval for some additional villages that we will be building. An update, since the last time we received our approval, we have started work. We've engaged a contractor.
Who is the contractor, by the way?
It's Emerald.
Okay. Same guys.
Same guys from the south, yes.
Okay.
They've done some clearing. They've installed the erosion control in the first phase, which is, again, so East Main is down here and Wilson is up there, just to orientate everybody. So Legacy Farms Road North is the spine road that's been built, and our first area of construction is off to the right on the east side, okay? So we've installed erosion control, we've cleared some trees, and we've met with Don McAdam, the conservation agent. We've done a pre-construction walk, and we've got the okay to start. It actually is pretty fantastic. If you all drive up there now, what you can see is we've actually mowed the field going back. So now you can start to see the view and the topography that we talked about all through the.
Okay, so you're not going to put any houses in there, just the all grass.
Just gonna leave it the way it is. It looks nice.
It does. Yeah. Actually, really look nice. There's a long view down. Okay. So the reason why we're here is we're starting to involve other departments and we're getting into construction, and there's a few items that we need to request modifications from you all. Hopefully we think you'll deem them a minor. So the first one, as Ken mentioned, is a temporary sewer. So the location of the temporary sewer is over here in A1, sequence 1 in the Northeast Village. We're intending, as far as the first phase, is to build a model park and put our sales offices in the first duplex of the first homes on Spruce Street or on Road C, as it was called in the approved plan. And the approved sewer design actually goes 1,800 feet down Spruce Street down to the sewer pump station that's at the low spot of the village. So in order to put in all of that infrastructure, in order to build all of that roadway, in order to get that sewer pump station up and operational, we're looking at until probably mid to late summer of 2017. And that's problematic because, as I was mentioning, one of the first things we need to do is to create this auto park in our sales offices, which are right at the beginning as you turn onto Spruce Street. Mm-hmm. And in order to occupy and to use the model park and the offices, we need sewer. order to get an occupancy permit, certificate of occupancy from the building department, we need to have sewer. So, and the timing doesn't work for our model park versus in building the sewer pump station and all the infrastructure down to the bottom. So,
and that time frame is what?
To build the sewer pump station, the roadway, it's probably about a year. It's late next summer. So what we need to do and what our contractors are doing right away is building the roadway in front of the models in the sales park. And we want to build over the winter so that when the spring season is upon us, we will be ready to go to have our sales offices and to be able to hit the spring season, selling season. So what we've done is, and in your packet, we've prepared an engineering, temporary wastewater design, temporary sewer design. It's been done by Dan Coughlin, Coughlin Engineering. It's in your packet. It's been submitted to Beta. Beta has peer reviewed it. They provided comments. We responded back to Beta last week. And I think as of today, we've got a final confirmation from Beta that we've addressed all of their comments. And it's really a temporary situation. It's a very temporary sewer design. And what we'll do is we'll install the permanent approved sewer in the roadway in front of the model park. And then it continues, the sewer continues all the way down to the pump station. But what we'll do is we'll put an E1 grinder pump in one of the manholes at the end of the model park. And we'll install controls and it will actually install the sewer with a 3-foot sump. So a sewer with a sump, and we'll put a grinder pump in the bottom of it. And it's like an E1 pump, and we've provided the cut sheets of the pump. And we'll install a temporary force main, which will force it, the sewer back up the new road and into Legacy Farms Road North, which is where the last sewer manhole is, that sewer manhole, which is part of the private Legacy Farms Road North sewer system, will carry the sewer down and down goes down to Clinton Street where the barn is and where the wastewater mm-hmm. treatment facility is. Private sewer, temporary situation, really important to our business of getting this model park up and running, engineered, and then when it's done, when the sewer pump station is open and operational, we will remove everything, we'll cap everything properly, we'll extinguish everything. And then we will use the approved plan as it was approved.
If I may ask you, there's two aspects that I'm looking at. And one is cost effective. Is this wouldn't a Title V
no.
be? And it's just
no.
This is a
this is cheap.
This is cheap.
Guarantee.
This is a very cost-effective.
Okay.
We looked at a number of alternatives,
and
this was definitely, when it was presented to us.
We put these on individual homes when I was sewer commissioner all around the lake, wherever you have a force main. I mean, there's a lot of these. Back in the 90s, they were $2,500,
$3,000
each.
Oh, okay.
This is relatively.
Yeah, and we're using some of the approved permanent sewer. We're really just...
Yep.
Modifying one manhole, okay. And
we
it's
have
them
on
one
the south side now.
Yeah.
Okay.
The wayside.
Real quick question.
Yep. Go ahead,
Mark. Can you just explain how the water taps into it, and that's no problem? Just
how the water.
Yeah.
Taps in? Well, the homes would be built and plumbed.
No, but
as
you're
they
like
would be.
You have a temporary sewer solution. You don't need a temporary water solution.
No.
Everything.
No, the water.
No, the water.
Okay.
So there's water in Legacy Farms or North. We'll,
okay.
we'll install the water in the roadway. The
just
services
while we're
into
on
the homes.
Thank you.
Yep. Yep. Thank
I'd
you.
Entertain a motion to consider the temporary sewer line as a minor change modification to the approved site plan and to approve it with the following condition: that within 3 months of the sewer pump station being operational, the temporary main will be discontinued and the sewer will revert back to the original.
Yep.
So after 3 months, you got 3 months to fix it over.
That's perfectly fine.
So
moved, seconded.
Second.
All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Anyone? You want to discuss it? Go ahead.
I think that it's a good short-term plan, but I think some of this should have been in the construction master plan. I'm disappointed that it was. So if we overlooked it or through the timing between inspections and when things could be built, so I think this is the best answer.
Thank you. If
go ahead.
If I may, just not to belabor it. So, during the process, we did discuss a little of the office park and the fact that we would be having these sales offices in the model homes, yes, rather than on the south side, right when you go down Legacy Farm Road South, we have a temporary trailer there. And we had mentioned that we were considering doing the model park and doing something a little bit differently on this side. So we did mention it. And I think just the big picture is we put a lot of time and effort into this plan for the approval, but it is a large project, and it will be built out over many years. So I hope that we'll have the opportunity to continue to come back to this board, you know, freely when we see items that could be improved or could be done differently, because it's a big project and it makes a lot of sense to continue to communicate.
As long as you put thought into it, I appreciate that.
I think we're ready for a vote. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Anyone abstain? Motion carries. Okay, the next thing I want to talk about, because I'm trying to get us back on schedule here, is to talk about the model home additional parking lot, which is a change.
I'll try to be a little briefer. So this is the same exact area. This is Spruce Street, Road C, coming in off of the Spine Road. And in your packet, there's an 11x17 color site plan. And this is a temporary sales office model park. The first duplex, as you drive in, will be the sales offices. And these are where our sales staff will work with the buyers and go through the sales process. And this is, as I just mentioned, is different than the southern side where we had the temporary trailer. So this is, I think, an aesthetically better looking process and more effective sales process for our teams. So then the next simplex, two simplexes and duplex will be furnished as model homes, and those will be furnished and we'll be able to take our customers into those homes to show them different home types. We did contemplate this during the approval process. As you can see, we have some simplexes and duplexes intermingled there, so that was kind of thought out at the time. Important aspects of the model park is you'll see there's a temporary paved parking area as you come in next to the model homes, or next to the sales offices, and that's designed to provide parking for our clients or our future home buyers, and it's off-street safe parking for our buyers. The last thing we want is people to drive in and to be parking on the streets and wandering around to get into the sales office. So the design is a safe paved parking area, which we've added a snow storage area, and we've added a grass drainage swale, and those were added to address comments from Beta that we received last week. And then there's a safe paved walkway throughout the model park, which carries home buyers into the sales offices. And then they would meet our sales team, and then our sales team would be able to accompany the home buyers through another temporary walkway system in order to get to the different models. And the last component I think is important to mention is we've proposed a white picket fence along this side of the roadway. And that's will look nice, and in addition, will prevent buyers from just driving themselves and parking on the roadway and going into the model homes directly. What we really want to do is facilitate a system, again, that they park safely in a designated area, and then through signage, they walk into the temporary offices, and then they meet the sales team, and then the sales team directs them to the model they're interested in, they can accompany them, and we don't want people just walking into them on their own. We've used this at other projects in other communities, and this system really, really works well. Temporary system, so at the end of sales, at the end of the use of these models and sales offices, we would revert back to, again, to the approved plan exactly the way it was previously approved. I know, Ken, we've talked a little about the parking area there, and we're open to your suggestions.
One of the
on
conditions that,
that
we I'd like to include, or when Jennifer and I met with him, is that we revisit this temporary parking. I think depending on how the school bus pick up, this parking might end up being more valuable than you think. Maybe it doesn't have to be as big, and it does impact a little bit on that first house there, a little bit too much. But, you know, maybe, so I'm suggesting a condition that the planning board will revisit the temporary parking lot prior to the discontinuance of the model home to determine that some parking spaces should remain.
Good suggestion.
Okay. So I think we're ready for a vote on this, and unless there are any other questions.
Real quick discussion point to that point. It looks like the side closest to the street would be great to replace it, right? And then, you know, like you just kept along the street this parking lot, it would replace that, right?
No, it's like, mm-hmm. No, it's in addition to.
In addition to, okay. Yeah.
I mean, you've got 400 and something homes. If you've got a gazillion mothers dropping off, we don't know whether the school bus is going to go down in the interior of Spruce Street or something like that, which I would kind of hope that they would, because I really don't want the school buses, if at all possible, stopping on Legacy North. You know, that just gums up the traffic more so than not. But we have no control over where the buses go, so, and when they go. So and there'll probably be a bunch of years that they would, if there's construction going on, I guarantee they won't be going down side street.
Right.
So anyway, I entertain a motion to approve the temporary sales office area, including parking and fences and lack of driveways, and with the condition that we'll revisit this prior to the discontinuance of the model homes.
I need a little bit more information.
Okay, go ahead.
Do we need to collect money in case they're gone and we need to revert this parking lot to park or whatever the original plan was, a park at this location?
There was original landscape.
Yeah. If I may, we did post recently a $100,000 bond with Jennifer in order to cover any construction issues that may occur.
That should be more than enough. We normally do.
The one on the south was $25,000, so this board had already increased it to $100,000 that we accepted during the process.
Thank you so much.
Question, Mr. Chairman?
Yeah, go ahead.
A quick one. On the street, on Spruce Street there, where you've got the white picket fence, are there also going to be no parking signs as well, so people can't, like, put their flashes on and kind of check in? You want everybody to park, and I get it, and then walk to the model units, correct?
If I may, Mr. Chairman. So, I would prefer, I mean, that's a good idea and a good comment, but the way that we tend to look at signage is it's responsive. So, in other words, we try to avoid going overboard with a lot of signs in the beginning. So, in other words, what I'm saying is if we notice a problem, then we'll correct the problem. And if it means signage, then we don't have a problem
with
signage.
And they would probably be temporary anyway.
Yes, any signage would be as long as the model park is going to be there.
I'm sure there's some signs that are going to say parking for model homes and stuff like that.
That's right. And we'll have directional signage.
I don't think we need to get into those details. I mean, they have an incentive to make this look good because this is what they're selling.
Absolutely.
Okay.
Thank you. I'm
expecting a motion to approve the temporary sales mile office, including parking and picket fence, with that one condition. Do I hear a motion?
So moved.
Second.
Moved and seconded. Further discussion? Seeing none, how do you vote?
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Anyone abstain? Motion carries.
I'm saying nay, because I'm against that condition. I think it's a good temporary move, but I don't want it to ever be a parking lot forever.
Okay. Okay, now the last one is a little bit more different. And basically explain the additions off of Holly Trail to everyone.
Yeah. Okay. Again, this goes back to, you know, refinement and coming back to the board for improvements. So the location that we're talking about here, if everybody is in a different village. So this is the Northwest Village, which is when you come off of Legacy Farms Road North, the North Club Village is the first village, and then you drive through and it's the Northwest Village. So the location that we're discussing this modification is actually this cul-de-sac, which is known as Road N. And I think just stepping back in time, so we've noticed an inefficiency in the plan, and we've come up with an improvement to the plan for a variety of different reasons of I can walk through. But the evolution of this village was a number of reasons which led to this situation. First of all, our original plan had a through road and a loop. And through good planning, we identified this large clump of existing vegetation, which is actually pretty unheard of on this previous farm. So we ended up breaking the road in order to preserve and save this existing mature vegetation ledge. That's why it wasn't farmed. So, and then through various discussions with the board and with the fire, we ended up converting a lot of hammerheads or turnarounds on these short common driveways into cul-de-sacs, which we were happy to do and which are part of the approved plan. That's great. So, but then after having various people look at this plan and looking at ways to improve the plan, what we've requested permission to do is actually omit the cul-de-sac road end through a very, very, what we believe to be minor modification, there's only six units, there's three duplexes on this cul-de-sac. The cul-de-sac is in the ledge part of the project. This is the area where we expect rock. It's a large, large cut. So what we've proposed is to take these six units and to just locate them on Holly Trail, I guess it is, and they fit very easily. You could put two duplexes, and it's shown on this exhibit that's been provided. You just put two duplexes where the cul-de-sac entrance was, and then we've shifted very, very minorly the other duplexes in this village, and we're able to fit a duplex right up at the beginning of Holly Trail. We've ensured to be consistent in the design of Holly Trail with the rest of the community. We've confirmed to make sure that we have 20 feet of driveway behind the sidewalk so that the cars parking in the driveway are not parking into the sidewalk and into the roadway. That was a comment that Veda had. We've ensured as part of the design to stagger the front facades of the homes as you drive down the street, like we've done in previous designs, so that the homes aren't all in a line. We made that change on the revised plan that we sent over. So what we're proposing is to remove essentially 300 feet of impervious cul-de-sac pavement. This will allow for over an acre, almost an acre and a half of previously disturbed cut in rock to now remain in its natural state. So there's less impervious surface, there's less work, the unit count stays the same, the design is consistent with the rest of the project, and Beta has reviewed this proposed minor, or what we consider minor change, and they had a comment, we addressed their comment, and we have an okay from them as well. So that's the presentation.
That's not the approved plan. Where is it?
That is the approved.
That is the approved.
The three cul-de-sacs is approved.
Yeah, okay. This cul-de-sac in the middle that we proposed.
The proposed change.
Yeah, that's the proposed change.
Yeah, it does. It's a little bit.
Well,
hard
just
to
I
pick
didn't
up
see. I don't remember clearly, but I don't see any cul-de-sacs anywhere else, but other than those three, right?
There's one over here.
Oh, there's one.
And there was one over there that through the process we made a through road at the request of this board. Yeah, and
right.
Here we added the nice boulevard at the
so
request.
Where's the other one? Sorry.
This
oh,
one was
again.
Over
okay.
Over
thank
here.
You.
Okay. So, where are we on this, Jennifer? Do we need more? Is this conceptual, and they have to provide some more plans of some sort, or?
I don't believe so. I think they've submitted.
Do we have like landscape plans that might go with this? That might have been part of.
I don't believe so.
Is there there original landscaping there?
There are
at present.
There is, yeah.
So you'll be leaving that?
Well, what we'd be doing is, obviously we wouldn't be landscaping the omitted cul-de-sac, so we would continue the theme of the landscaping in the
on Holly Trail in front of the units that we relocate there.
For example, for them to come back and take some of that out of the restricted land and change that around, that is a special permit with a major hearing. So right now they're not proposing to change any of the use. They're building within the buildable land
that we already
approved. This might be a good thing to do in the future to make it more restricted land, because they might need buildable land elsewhere, and you know, you're making a good trade-off for that.
Yep.
I think it works out fine. Simplifies things. A lot less blasting for people, which is always good. Any further questions? Or go ahead.
I have a question. I see that the two houses, two duplexes, are shifted to where the street was, and then the corner of Cherry Lane on Holly Trail is the third duplex, and then the other three duplexes on that side of Holly Trail are moving down. But I'm wondering about the corner space that had been there, the green space. The single houses on Cherry Lane are going to have that view now with a house more near them, and I'm wondering about just the density of that. Are there any setbacks that we're overlooking or in this regard, or?
Yeah, that's a good question. When we did this design, we looked very carefully at the setbacks and the views of the rears, and we are comfortable with the separation that's between the simplex and the rear of the duplexes. It's very, very consistent with really the rest of the community. It's not any closer. It provides more than enough separation from our perspective. We have not sold that home and the simplex home, so there's not a buyer that expected something differently. You know, the buyer who would be buying the home, this is the plan, if it were approved, that they would be looking at.
Through the chair.
Go ahead.
And over to Frank.
Remember, we have to get moving.
Yeah, so Frank, the only thing that I say is that if you look at the whole layout,
it's a gain overall.
Right, and then also all of the houses that are adjacent to each other are very close too. So that proximity of those replacement places seems to follow pattern across the board.
Okay. I think we're ready for a vote on this. I'd entertain a motion that this is a minor modification and that we eliminate road in and reconfigure the units around it. Moved and seconded. Further discussion, seeing none. How do you vote? Aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Anyone abstained? Motion carried. Thank you very much. Now, last thing with these guys, just for your information, they have added on a different design of a simplex, I believe, and they're going to take one away. We will discuss that at a later date after design review has had a chance to look at it. And so that's coming up. So, okay?
That's great.
Should we pick a time for that upcoming meeting?
So we're meeting on December 20th with design review, so I had assumed on January 9th we would.
Sure. That's fine.
That.
No problem at all.
Yes.
Okay.
Thank you very much.
Thank you all.
Thank you, gentlemen.
Appreciate
it. Nice to see
you. Have a good holiday.
Yes. Thank you also.
Okay. I'll have to get there and see the meadow.
Make us all proud.
Thanks. Thank you.
Okay. The next item on it is 66 Fruit Street. Mr. Novinsky and crowd, come on down.
Come on down.
Thanks again.
See you, Mark.
Chat for a minute, and then I'll give you a quick overview of the project. My name's Kathy Hervel. I'm with Gale Associates, and we're here representing the Hopkinton Parks and Rec Committee. We're here requesting approval of a minor modification to the existing site plan for the Fruit Street Field for the proposed amenity building. So, with that, joining me is Mr. Kvinsky, the chairman of Parks and Rec, as well as Bob McGuire, who's heading the subcommittee affiliated with the amenities building. So. And we also have Sean Gunnan, who is with S3 Design, who's the architect of the building, the amenities building. So so with that, I just quickly going to take you through the plans. The Parks and Rec is proposing about a 1,500 square foot amenities building. Just to give you a sense of what it's going to look like, we have an overhang area in this area that's about 1,300 square feet. Give you some picnicking area. We also want to have a place where, should it storm or whatever, we figure we can get about 100 people under that cover out in the facility. We're proposing a concession area, three unisex type restrooms, as well as storage that the Park and Rec needs for equipment and such out at the fields. So just to kind of give you the overview of the site plan, the existing synthetic turf fields sit here. The existing parking area is here. Obviously, the long drive down off of Fruit Street down this way. We have, like I said, proposing the building to sit just between the existing parking and the field. We'll be reworking the walkways and such, basically tying into that area. We have some specialty pavers proposed. As far as utilities, we have an existing water line and sewer line which run right along this edge of the parking area. We're proposing to tap into those. This line is a force main, so we will be doing a small pump station just required to offset the pressures affiliated with that. We're also opposing some modification. We have to upgrade the electrical line. We have an existing electrical panel and meter down in this area, but unfortunately right here is our 100-foot buffer zone. So we would be doing some minor work, potential minor work in this area. We've been in contact with Mr. McAdams with the Conservation Commission. The order of conditions for the overall fields is still open, due partly to the Permanent Extension Act. So we were able to go in with what they call a notice of project change to cover these small impacts within this buffer zone. As far as stormwater goes, in your packet, we included a HydroCAD analysis that we did that basically there's an existing infiltration basin that sits right here on the part in the facility. We basically showed that this facility, the infiltration basin is very over-designed. I don't know if you saw the numbers of pre- and post-conditions, but we were able to show that with our, I guess we've estimated we're increasing impervious area by about 5,200 square feet. Like I said, the calculations, I know the precondition is like 49 CFS, and even with this new development, I think we're about 18 CFS, so we're way below the criteria. The other thing I'd just like to mention, because this will be servicing the existing facility as is, we're not proposing any additional parking at this time. And that's really it.
Okay. The first thing we have to do is determine whether it's a major or minor change to the existing plans that we've done. I think, to me, it's a concession stand on the major use in parking and stormwater, et cetera. It's all been taken care of before with this. So I personally, when Jennifer said it's a minor, I tended to agree with her on that. And do we have a consensus that it's a minor?
So I have one question. Because there's history here, and some of the new members don't know what happened when, but and I'm a little confused, haven't been here. Good to see you guys.
Thanks for having us.
I like this, what I'm looking at, but is this the same as what we discussed at a town meeting?
Yes. Go ahead.
Would you like an explanation?
Go ahead, but quickly.
Yes. At the town meeting, we requested $500,000 of CPC funds for the amenity building. At a subsequent town meeting, we had asked for a loan for a sports facility, for an indoor sports facility, not covered under CPC.
That's different.
That's different, right. And that is not part of this building at all, and that's still under consideration where we're doing a feasibility study to understand what the size of that building needs to be based on the sports groups coming back to us and said the $500,000 really wouldn't generate a building big enough.
And that would be to the left, right?
Presently, it's
as you go in, right? Where this is going to be right
in front.
Time out. Tonight, we're only talking about this building. No, that is a major one.
I just wonder where it's located, that's all.
It won't be located anywhere near this because they're going to have to put parking like all over for that thing.
Right.
Because that will require parking.
Mr. Chairman, can I speak to that since the question did come up? So
for the proposed location for that building, taking into account a parking study that's been funded.
I don't think we want to go there. That's not the point of my question.
Right here is where the building would be.
I don't think you'll find parking there.
Next to it.
I don't think
I thought I originally saw a way to the left.
So through the chair, my answer's been questioned. My question's been answered, so thank you. And thank you.
Sorry to take up your time.
Okay.
You're not taking up our time.
Well, I agree that it's a small front.
Everyone's agreed it's a minor change. Okay. So, are there questions on it? Let's start with stormwater. And I'm just going to quickly go through it because I'm trying to get through this in about 2 minutes. Stormwater, it's on a gravel pit. We discussed it when we approved the original site, that whole thing. It's worked well. It's always dry, even after it rains. Plenty of capacity. Okay?
Yep.
Traffic parking, this is an amenity for an existing use. No more traffic. You know, well, you might get one more person in front of the concession stand, but other than that, you know, it's going to be insignificant, or a couple more people on the concession stand, but that's probably about it.
Landscaping, I think they're taking down a couple trees.
I believe so. That area's open at this point.
What's that?
The flagpole. We're just going to relocate the flagpole.
I thought there were some trees along the sidewalk.
There are two trees right in front that will come out.
Do you have any plans for moving those? Can we move them over to the area to the right there, the open area, or some other area within there?
For sure.
Yeah.
Okay. So.
I'd like to see some solar panels on the roof if you guys can swing it. It's not that much more, and it pays for itself.
We're taking it into account with the final design and additional CPC funding.
It might make some sense given the
open space.
No, given the lack of power on that facility area.
Mm-hmm.
Whatever.
Or now they're renting, which is being paid for by the people using the field, but they're renting lights, which makes the field more usable for later hours. And
we don't want to get into lights tonight because I'm not sure whether we approve lights for the field, but that's another point.
We thank you.
And there is a bylaw on lights too, that potentially restricts even temporary lights on it. So you guys might want to look at that one.
Thank you,
Mr. Chairman. Question.
Yeah.
Guys, is the refreshment stand, is it going to be open flame in there, or is it just going to be typical?
Similar to a doghouse.
Yeah.
Answer the question.
Very minimal.
Not electric, EMC.
Just one point, there's no baseball field there. Okay.
Slushy machine?
Yeah. Okay.
So. The 1,500 square feet, is that the interior building? You talked about putting 100 people under the overhang. Does that include that?
No, the 1,500 is the...
building itself.
Between the concession, the restrooms, and storage, and then the overhang is 1,300.
Okay.
So it's the size of a typical house built in the late 80s in Hopkinton.
Miles.
Mr. Chairman, after we vote
not
on
the 1880s.
Miles, after we vote on that, can we just keep them for 1 minute? Ask them a question up on that.
We will ask them a couple of questions because I got something else to keep you on too.
Sorry, you're behind me. I went first.
That's okay. That's okay. Anything else anyone needs to know?
When are you looking at building?
Sooner rather than later.
December.
Soon as we can get through the process.
Okay. Yeah.
Probably spring or summer.
Spring into summer, hopefully.
Well, you need more money. That's the key. We'll get to talk to that in a second. I entertain a motion to consider this a minor modification and to approve the minor change for the concession.
I think it was already moved. So moved. Seconded, I thought.
Did we?
No.
I don't think so. No. I don't think we did.
I thought Frank jumped in.
No, I don't
think. Okay, whatever.
So moved.
Moved.
Second.
Okay. Further discussion? Seeing none, how do you vote?
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Anyone abstained? Motion carried.
That was 2-1.
What?
That was 2-1.
2 for the price.
The size of
the 2 for
the It was the minor and the approval.
Yes.
That's good. Thank you.
Yes. Okay, we're getting okay. So now, Dave, you get your first question.
Thanks, Ray. So, the net that you put up, I noticed that when we're playing soccer there, the netting is on the outside of the 4-foot fence there.
Mm-hmm.
The balls are getting trapped down there. People have to climb over the fence to get it, and they're going to trash the new net. I think it can be pulled onto the inside of the
sure.
fence without moving it and restructuring it. Just
there's ways of tying it to the existing
sure,
fence.
Whatever will work, that okay. keep the balls on the yep. planting side.
Yep. $50,000.
Good point.
Yeah, it's not okay. cheap.
My next question.
I'm done. I'm quick. Okay.
Good. I'm your CPC representative, planning board members. They have come in for a $400,000 increase in their budget from this from CPC. So it goes from $500,000 to $900,000 to build this particular building. And quite frankly, I still have not come to grips in my own mind how you built three bathrooms, a kitchen that's less than most standard kitchens in Hopkinton, and storage space, which has got some lights and some concrete walls, and it takes $900,000.
Right.
And my question to you guys, because I'm looking for input as to how to vote. To me, $900,000 seems to be incredibly high. I mean, we built 4,500. We built a storage or a over a pavilion at the high school, or no, at Hopkins yeah, School, so that kids could get underneath it.
$4,000?
No, it was about $40,000 or something, 35, I think. I forget. Somewhere
Mr.
in that range. And then it was, but you got three bathrooms, and you know, I know they're going to be not destructible bathrooms, but it's still three bathrooms, and I just don't see how you get. And my question is, you got $900,000. Basically, that would take and build the base coat for another athletic turf field. I mean, you know, or you know, do something on that athletic parcel. I don't know whether I'm having a hard time finding justification for $400,000 more for here. And therefore, I'm asking the rest of you guys to give me your thoughts because I'm voting your vote.
I would like to know if they've gone through the bid process.
Can I speak to some of Ken's questions?
Yeah.
And then what I'd like to do is rely on the firms that we hired to go ahead and put together these rough costs for us and let them go ahead and so you can understand their findings. Then I'd like to respond further as to why we've gone ahead and asked for this $400,000 during this time. Kathy, Sean, you want to speak to that? The estimating process?
Yeah. So based on amenities buildings that we've done at now three other high schools, the increases of costs of construction have gone up every year. And we're doing just based on a square footage calculation, this is rough, we're talking about a facility that's costing less than $250 a square foot, which is cheaper than what we found to be happen in other districts. So we've tried to make this building cheaper than buildings that we've already built at previously.
Through the chair. How does it go to almost double from what it was originally?
Can I speak to that?
Yeah, please.
So originally we went to the town meeting for the CPC funds. We had a preliminary design done from the folks that originally put in the turf fields. They drew up a little drawing. We went to town meeting. We presented it. We were awarded the CPC funds. And then subsequently we did not hire that company. Possibly their estimations were off. We also sizably increased the storage size of this building to accommodate eliminating all the storage trailers up there that are a little unsightly.
Mm-hmm.
We have addressed the transgender issue with the restrooms by having three individual ones. And I think it's a sign of the times, as Sean pointed out.
But my question is the bathroom was the three bathrooms were already slated, right?
No.
No. Well, I didn't see the original layout building. I think it was very basic. Keep in mind, this building is, and I'm the civil engineer, Sean's the architect, but the building will be able to be operated, you know, three seasons of the year, you know, with it's going to be heated. So it does impact your foundations and things along those lines, too, that increase cost. Like I said, I did not have privy to the previous layout and what they included. It could have just been, you know, a very simple structure.
You didn't look at that, though? I mean,
we weren't provided it. We kind of came in with our own approach. They had an idea, and we've worked through them what they need, the programming, and you know, I don't know what the original building, I think, was a similar size, but what was the programming, I can't speak to those details. I just know that we've gone through with them what we call our building program, you know, all the questions like you asked, what's going to be in the concession, you know, the restroom issues, because they have to be big enough now because we do the unisex, but they still got to take handicap. So, you know, it's not just a small bathroom. They've got to be a certain size, which does increase things.
Could there be a solid, a more solid number that might be chiseled down to some length? I mean, $400,000. This is mm-hmm. we're all talking about the same thing. I think is that it's nearly double of what the cost was originally, and that's why it got approved, was because of that number. That the town allotted that, mm-hmm. right? Because it went to town meeting. All right, so now we're behind the scenes
CBC.
Thank you, CBC, and so we have to make that decision now on spending the town's money.
We'll
go back to town meeting for the additional funding.
Yep. Okay. Yep.
Can I speak to the CBC? Ask Ken if you don't through the chair. So originally, our commission back about 7-8 years ago had somewhere in the neighborhood of $350,000 to $375,000 for renovations at Reed Park. That's even before the turf fields were put in. Mm-hmm. We were tasked to replace the turf fields with the next number of years, and subsequently that money has gone back to CPC. We didn't spend it.
Right.
Because this now is the crown jewel of Hopkinton and the only turf fields it has. The high schools play in there, the middle schools play in there. Tournaments are there through March. So we as a commission feel very good about asking for additional funds to enhance this property, first putting it on in a little neighborhood park.
But that neighborhood park still is a good park.
Mm-hmm. Not truly, but I don't think it deserved it. Our commission didn't believe it deserved the $350,000, because here we can get more of a return on our investment.
Absolutely.
So to replace the turf fields and serve the constituents.
Well, we got to cut this really short.
Can I ask a question about the architect's numbers, please?
One more question on it, and then.
So you were saying $250 per square foot?
Yes.
But isn't most of the building just a pavilion with a roof over it and poles? And I mean, what percentage of the building is that, first of all?
That's half for the overhang.
Yep.
So half of the square footage for the overhang, and then the building itself is the number works out to be about 2,000 square feet. If you take half of the number of the overhang and then you add it to the building, it's about 2,100 square feet.
So would it be safe to say roughly that it's really $500 per square foot? Because it's half of it's just an overhang? Well, I mean, if you did about 2,000 square feet, right?
No,
half of it?
It would be, the numbers work out to be, if you made a bigger building that was 2,100, still be $250 a square foot. But this building's only 1450 with a 1300 square foot overhang. So that equates to a 2100 square foot building.
I just want to make a comment. I'm not going to ask a question because I've asked a question, and I want to note that it has not been answered about the bid process. And the context of that was I was the co-chair for the roof project at Keefe Tech, and we spent $2 million on the entire roof of the entire campus of Keefe Tech. And if this little tiny building cost $900,000 3 years later, I'm kind of amazed.
We're still at a conceptual plan.
But have you been through the bid process, put it out to bid?
No, we haven't gone that far.
Just one final comment.
We've got to wrap this up, because otherwise we're going to be here till 11 o'clock.
Just a wrap-up statement. I am totally for this building. I want this building to be built.
Me
I just
too.
Don't want it to be shot down at town meeting. I think we're all saying the same thing.
Yeah.
I'm
afraid.
Yeah.
A larger portion of the cost is associated with bringing the plumbing and electric
Bob's,
that's a good point.
Bob, we went back, Bob, you can speak to going back to the design process from the original estimate we had.
Yeah, we've tried to work just from a high level where the number would be, and we've asked, I think, three different people to help us. They're all coming in pretty close. We have not gone to a general contractor. We don't have construction drawings to get hard pricing. I mean, clearly, we'd love to have to see the number down, too.
Right. So what do you have to bring in from the street? Water all the way? Or
no, no, water's no, there. It's a fair amount of site work. I'm not sure how much of that was. Yeah. How much is site work? 250?
It was about
250. 250 of the total number is site work.
We're about the only department that's taken advantage of the town's purchase at Fruit Street and really done some true development there.
No, I understood.
We're very thankful that we were given some additional property during the new master plan. So we're just looking to build on that.
Yeah.
And we agree the $400,000 would be a big ask
right.
if our department, I think, didn't give back because we recognize this is a better focus. So, Ken, we should probably take this offline if you have some additional concerns.
Okay.
Chairman.
Well,
chairman.
Anyone else can email me because I think it's Thursday night. I've got a CPC meeting. And we might vote on it. So people can give me
this
some
Thursday?
Thought. Yep. Okay. I think we're all set. We did vote it, right?
Yes.
Yeah.
That's all set.
So, okay.
And just a note. Another turf field will be fantastic there. We can like start hosting some tournaments and stuff. So I know you guys.
You're aware of the school's initiative as far as the turf field.
Which
and, we,
is,
okay. And we came to the rescue this year with the lights.
Yes.
Sorry, Ken.
Yeah. Okay, Bill?
Thank you, gentlemen.
Thank you, Chairman.
Good evening, Chairman.
Yep.
Good evening.
We've got an A&R plan. Why don't you, in 2 minutes, explain what you're doing, and then we're going to approve it. after she says that it meets the requirements.
It does.
It meets the requirements. Okay, so I'll just explain what you have to do.
Well, very simply, I came in and I had an A&R plan approved by the board. And when we went to CONCOM sent it over to Mike, over to zoning, and zoning found that we had made an error in that each lot has to have the driveway going out of the frontage of that lot. So it's very simply, we came back to get we restructured the lot so we can have the driveways going out of each lot to meet the zoning requirement.
And there was some email going back from Mike Shepherd.
Yes, so what had happened was in your previous A&R plan, the way the lots were configured, one of the lots, pretty much the entire frontage was wet. So in order for them to get a driveway, they would have had, the best option was a common driveway, but there's a caveat in our common driveway bylaw that says you can't use that to make a unbuildable lot buildable.
Got it.
And in effect, that's what they were doing. So the simplest and easiest way for him to fix that was to come in with a new A&R plan.
That was CONCOM's suggestion. It was a zoning Mike's suggestion. And tonight plans went to CONCOM, and they approved it. So,
okay. I entertain a motion, if there's no further questions, to assign the A&R.
So just for a point of clarity, there's one existing house. I've never asked this question before, but... There's one existing house and then two new lots, and lot 2A is not buildable. And you were just changing the lines to fit better. Is that correct?
No, lot 2A will be buildable.
Yes, yeah, sure.
2A and 1A. 1A is this whole thing right here, and that will be buildable, and then 2A will be buildable.
So there's three new houses?
No, because this and this
are
the same lot.
Don't you have...
One, it's a pork chop lot.
Oh.
There's a lot of wetlands over in this area.
Right.
So you end up with about a third to a half an acre,
Right.
And you've got room for the driveway to go through and room for the driveway to go through.
But he does have the frontage to fit his house here. He does have the zoning.
This shows the house.
He's got the blocks.
Yes. Okay. It's not shown on
paper
there.
Road trail is the border in the back.
Yes, that's correct.
Okay. Entertain a motion to approve the A&R.
So moved.
Second.
Moving seconded. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Anyone opposed? Anyone abstain?
Abstain.
Yes.
Just don't know. I'd like to think about it longer.
Okay. So, if somebody can sign, a couple of you guys can sign this thing and we'll keep moving on.
I'll give it a
thank you.
I'll give it a signature.
And the mylar.
He can take it.
Why don't you go around? Okay, to try to move things along, next one I want to take up is the notice for a bylaw amendment for recreational marijuana. I was invited to a meeting with the selectmen, I want to say 2 weeks ago-ish, maybe a little bit longer before that. They had the two chiefs, we had the... Thank you. We had... Lane was there. We had people from the Youth Commission, I believe. Steve, who else was there? Selectman. So basically, we had a discussion about, and we had Ray Mieres for the town council. And this discussion got around is, how do we implement the new law that was passed by the people of the Commonwealth regarding recreational marijuana? And what came out of the meeting was that, number one, the state has not certified all these wonderful rules and regulations yet, or certified the vote. And they haven't established all the regulations as to how these things might work. And so nobody has a clue of what you want to do from a zoning aspect. And at a special town meeting that was called for other reasons, Ashland, our neighbor next door, was the first town to vote to put a moratorium on it to allow it time to figure out what's going on with this law. For further background, we had a moratorium when we had the medical marijuana here, and it took us another year to, after the rules and regulations got established, is to figure out how we wanted to deal with it in local. Law was written relatively poorly. It was a citizen's petition. So a lot of the folks down at the State House are saying, oh my God, how do we implement that? Nobody's ever used language that is like that, and what does that vote mean? I think to prohibit it out and out, which would be an option, I'm not sure, and we didn't discuss that terribly much at the meeting, would require not only a vote at town meeting, but then a vote at a general election, ballot question. So, but it was really weird and kind of weird, and quite frankly, Ray says, and even the other people at the meeting, the consensus was, let's do a moratorium and figure out, after everyone's figured it out, what the rules are, how we're going to zone for it. And so basically what we have in here, in your package, was a meeting notice to hold the public hearing on a zoning change. And once we do that public and publish that in the paper, that freezes zoning at this point. So even though the town meeting hasn't voted for it, it's as of that point when it gets out into the public, as of today, the law doesn't get implemented till the 15th of December. If it gets certified, I suspect it'll get certified by the 15th of December. Mm-hmm. On the 15th or 16th of December, somebody could come in and say, I want to build a recreational sales building here, and I want to sell marijuana under the new law right there. If we vote tonight to put the notice in, then that freezes zoning as it is today. And if somebody came in with the building permit, our building inspector would say, I'm sorry, I can't allow it. It's not allowed by zoning as of today. Or you have a risk of going through. So I think I got it right.
You did.
I did. So if other facts that were brought out, marijuana was narrowly defeated in this town by, I want to say, 400 or 700 votes out of the gazillion the votes that got cast in the presidential election in Hopkinton. So that's where it is.
Can I
Can I add to that, Ken?
Yeah, go ahead.
All right, two things. One is competitive towns are already vying for dispensaries, and Hopkinton was slated for a dispensary at our particular meetings that we had in past. So that being said, if we put a moratorium on this and these other towns and surrounding towns continue to move forward, then would that constitute us to be left out of a possible business venture?
The way I would answer that is if the town voted to have marijuana, recreational marijuana, right now you can do the medical one within certain zones. The demand for that in Hopkinton would be such that if we zone for it, you will get one. Just like we have the maximum number of liquor stores, I guarantee you'll have it.
If you zone it, they will come.
And that's not to say there isn't a little bit of marijuana being smoked in this town, you know. We have a sign in the selectman's office that says we're the highest town in Middlesex County.
Which isn't true.
Which is not true. But anyway.
But to your point, Ken, it is now going to be really no different than tobacco and alcohol. And can we do a zoning, anything in the zoning that says the selectmen can decide, not to get it off our shoulders, but that we don't know if there's going to be licenses or anything, but
we don't know any of that stuff at this point. So therefore, the cautious thing is to put a moratorium until
January 17th.
Further information is available.
January 23rd.
No. It is until moratorium will effect through August 31st, 2018, which would allow us to consider it at not this May, but a year from May's annual town meeting.
But there's a meeting scheduled in the middle of January, right?
Yes.
That was where we'd have the public hearing, and that can be the public hearing on the article, and it could be, and we pick that January date, is there's most likely going to be a special town meeting in February to talk about the charter. We could bring it up at that particular meeting, or we could wait, because it is a zoning thing, up until the May annual town meeting. And that would be a decision that this board would make on that date. So today, all we would be doing is to vote to advance the moratorium article and hold a hearing on January 23rd.
So you don't, what you're saying, Ken, is you don't want to bring it to this town meeting coming up, you want a moratorium to the following town meeting.
We won't have rules and regulations in the Commonwealth by this May.
But wouldn't people be able to vote to give us a better idea of how that is looked at?
You've got to vote on a concrete proposal. You know, you might want to say that you put it in all the same places as medical marijuana is. Or maybe you just say wherever retail's allowed.
Right.
Or whatever. But I don't know all what's going on with the Commonwealth to make.
I don't think anybody does. And
nobody does.
It's a monetary value thing, though, that is the dilemma right now, isn't it? It's about how they're going to manifest money from the legalization of it.
The money issue, I think, is the minor. If you listen to all the stuff that happened out of Colorado, they didn't get enough money. In Massachusetts.
If we have an entity that wants to come into town and sell as a marijuana store, that's one thing. But what if one of our coffee shops want to sell marijuana products? I mean, I think that's since there's no oversight, I think we should maybe look at a bylaw that puts the power of, at least locally, licensing that to the board of selectmen.
I think to Ken's point, I think you will do that, but I think until the state establishes the commission to oversee the state rules and regulations and licensing, we don't even know if that will be possible, that other coffee establishments and things can sell edibles and whatnot. So until we know what the state is going to allow or how it's going to look from a state perspective,
for us to create a bylaw at this point, I think is short-sighted and won't do the town any favor.
To that, we're just buying some time, basically.
Right.
To that point, exactly. I'm sorry, mm-hmm. Frank. Yeah. All right, to that point, the question that I have is, the people of the town, people of the nation have spoken.
I understand.
And for us to put a moratorium on it.
It's just a temporary.
I understand this, but that's a 2-year moratorium.
One and a half years.
If things get clarified, we can always bring it up earlier. But
yeah, but what we're doing right now is we're sliding the vote. Mm-hmm.
So, and
I don't see that to be a right thing to do.
Let me make it more clear for you. So, I, in my professional opinion, don't think that we have time between now and when we would have to have a warrant article for May. To craft a warrant article that will do what the town needs it to do.
Wait,
let me finish 1 second, please. So we're already out to May of 2018 at that point. So this moratorium is just protecting us from people just willy-nilly coming in and doing whatever they want without us guiding how we want it to look. Do you understand what I'm saying?
I agree with you. And to that point again, I'm going to say that to restrict the vote of the people to a point where no one can even apply or do anything is an injustice to the rights of all people and the right of voting. And so if those people want to make that fight or make that determination, then someone other than this board should make that decision, which would be the selectmen.
No. By law, all the zoning board articles come through us.
Okay,
that's what you got elected to do.
Okay, so to that point, I still think that we're making a decision that is taking out the Constitution.
No.
Can I comment on that?
Go ahead.
Something's been illegal. The thing's been illegal for 100 years. Why do we have to rush into zoning?
I'm not talking about rushing.
You are talking about rushing.
No,
you
I'm not.
Just let the people vote.
No, I'm talking about a restriction that allows that doesn't allow any conversation.
No. We're going to have all sorts of conversation of what we want it to look like over the next year in crafting it. Right now, quite frankly, our other option was to vote a ban on the things, permanent ban on it, and quite frankly, with the voting in base in Hopkinton, and who would come to a special town meeting, and who comes to a whatever, I'll say it'll vote go down. Absolutely down.
Absolutely. Right. So may I make a comment, Mr. Chairman?
Yeah.
I think the course of action that's been outlined for yourself and Jennifer is prudent for the town right now. It gives us some breathing room until the state is able to kind of define better or draft some articles that we then could kind of leverage for a vote 2018.
Even the nation's still up in the air.
Oh yeah, no, and I agree with this. And this, my point is not to fight this. I'm saying that we gotta know that it was just voted on and passed, and that people are expecting that vote to be standing.
Right. Well, what if can we compromise and maybe have instead of have a 1-year period of instead of a year and a half?
Well, it has to go to town meeting.
We're not going to want to call a special town meeting just for this zoning article.
Well, no, then the next time this special town meeting comes up in the winter,
normally you don't have special town meetings.
We
will not be ready in this February. We're not going to be ready this May.
Right. Mm-hmm. But aren't we having a special town meeting in
Not in necessarily 2017.
Okay, so we just need some clarity on how this is.
I thought we have a special town meeting coming up in the winter because of the timing of the charter, which is the next topic we need to talk about.
This is coming up this February.
Yep.
Very shortly.
So right now, if we propose we need to have a hearing, which would be January,
correct.
And we have this hearing, and we say we're offering to put a moratorium on zoning.
How do people feel?
And for one year.
And if people don't want it at the time we bring it up,
they'll find out in January, right? We'll
find out in January. We'll find out at town meeting. If town meeting votes it this down, then it's wide open. There's every place there's a retail store,
allows marijuana.
But if we're suggesting it, it puts our stamp of approval on denial.
No, we're buying some time to figure out what we want to do
that.
With it.
But the public doesn't think that.
I'll tell you, the public in Ashland,
which voted for it at the polls, their town meeting voted overwhelmingly to put the
moratorium
on it. Okay. I mean, that's the prudent thing to do.
I agree.
Wholeheartedly.
And I would just argue that to say that because we're putting forward a temporary moratorium to buy us some time to figure out how we want to handle this, to say that makes us look like we, or not us, but the planning board looks like we don't support a bylaw.
That's my concern.
I think it's short-sighted.
Yeah, you're jumping to a conclusion.
I think it would depend on when Ken gets up at town meeting to do his presentation for zoning articles, you know, I think it would be incumbent upon him to, like, make the presentation he made tonight to say, you know, this is a temporary gap stop until we can get the regulations from the state so that we can position ourselves to determine how the town wants to handle recreational marijuana in the future.
Make a more educated decision.
Correct. Absolutely not in this town. Because that has not been decided yet.
Yeah. Yeah. Duly noted, and I wanted to have my voice on camera for that particular reason, is that there are public people out there that are probably throwing their arms up in the air and saying, what the heck? And I want us to make sure that we're looking at both sides of this venue, not just on what...
Of course, I have no idea what these numbers stand on this issue. Yeah.
Chief, I think
I just wanted to comment on the moratorium part, because the town needs to start thinking about how they're going to provide the public safety for some of the data that the chief talked about, the police chief that's come out of Colorado for emergency room admissions, motor vehicle accidents. For all the votes that go on, they had data that I have never seen before in public safety. So we need to prepare for it. That type of volume of impact of a change. So at least you have a breadth of one piece for public safety on a moratorium to start to prepare for how you're going to deal with it. I don't want to sound alarmist. The data, I've never seen data like that for anything else I'm dealing with in public safety.
Thank you for that. Yeah. So that gives me reason to change my perspective a little bit. And I just want the public to have a voice right at this moment, right now. We're on camera.
The public will have a voice at town meeting and at our public hearing. And we will have a public hearing if we so voted tonight. And then we'll listen to that and we'll see whether or not we go ahead and propose it continuing on. But
then I'm for.
Okay. Then I'm entertain a motion to do a notice of a public hearing
with condition
on January 22nd, 2017. January 23rd, 2017, with the potential for moratorium as written by town council.
So moved.
Second.
Discussion?
Sure. Go ahead.
Council. Sure, the discussion where we're having the discussion.
Robert's rules.
Sorry, go ahead.
I'm just looking at the Ray Miars's addition. Does not mention a date. And can you explain that date specifically is because of the timing? We need to put changes into place.
Well, yeah, that would allow us at this point to get through a May 2018 town meeting and also get the whatever changes certified by the Attorney General, et cetera, and allow to put it in there. And then also if we're going a way of approving it, and quite frankly, this is not gonna stop anyone to go buy it in Milford or wherever you can buy it
and
use it in Hockenden.
Larger towns, larger cities will have more business.
I'm sure Cambridge might do some quite a bit, but you know it.
No.
But
not Cambridge.
There's also a lot of restrictions, both at the federal government, that if you are caught, and it also doesn't change workplace, For example, public safety folks here have got a prohibition from it. If you're driving a DPW truck or comparable in the civilian, if you're doing it, if you own a gun, you know, that's one of the things that you're prohibited to. So, but those are things that'll get out when people start understanding this a little bit more.
Sure.
And so anyway, we have a, did we answer your question for discussion?
Yes, thank you.
Okay, are we ready for a vote?
Yes, we are. Yes,
all those in favor of putting the notice up for the moratorium on recreational marijuana, say aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Anyone
nay.
Saying, okay. Okay, now let's...
Let me explain my vote, because it's very serious. I say about this every town meeting.
Good.
There's a stigma that's existed, it's strong in this town against marijuana, but my mother had cancer, and she didn't trust taking marijuana and brownies. She needed her strength, and she didn't get that. She would have got it from having pot brownies. I'm glad that this law has changed. I'm glad that pot is not illegal, but it is a concern, Chief. Same as alcohol, same as tobacco.
And your mother can buy medical marijuana at all sorts of places today.
This is decades later.
I think you have Denise Hildridge as a. She's got some real talent on kind of the social piece that connects to what the kids are going to face, what the community is going to face. There are other people. It's good for us to kind of get more awareness around this.
Sure. It's a responsible.
And I agree.
That's why I voted no. Just
whatever. Okay. Next item. Because we got it.
Thanks, Chief.
What is the specific changes on the charter that we're talking about in regards to Jennifer? I don't see exactly that.
Well, if you...
Point of clarification is not in regards to Jennifer.
Well, yes. That's what I thought. That's how I was written.
I read the charter. It made no sense.
Is there a meeting coming up?
Yes. There is a public hearing on
this one?
Wednesday.
In the Senior Center at 7 p.m.
Okay.
December 7th.
To kind of cut through it, there is in your package a copy of an email that I was sent to primarily from Pat Waxlex, who's chairs the Charter Commission, and on the second page, basically it says, and they're doing it for the town planner, the library director, parks and recreation director, board of health agent, and conservation. They're proposing that they do a board appointment on recommendation from town manager in accordance with the human resources. So basically they're going to take the appointment of all these independent elected boards, and their key staff person is going to be the town manager. Supervision is done by the town manager with consultation. Basically, if you go down the goal setting, town manager sets the goals. This is completely what happened when the charter had the DPW director working for the town manager, and then you had a DPW board, which I was on just before they got rid of it, and the DPW board and the other ones quit, basically, and we went to a charter change to the state legislature, because the board needs the full ability to supervise, appoint, set the goals, evaluate the person that's going for. You know, if you go to Management 101, which a lot of you guys have gone to business school, have all had, authority and responsibility have to go hand in hand. You getting the authority elected by the town's people, we're not running a mayor where the town manager takes it from this board. I mean, the town manager can't go to all these board meetings. The town, you know, we're asking for something that just absolutely won't work. And Dan Terry from from Parks and Rec, he's kind of pushing from their standpoint there. They have strong input to it that they don't like the proposed changes, because it fundamentally will change what elected board can or can't not do. Mm-hmm. The only one that can supervise would be the town manager, and the only one that supervises him is the Board of Selectmen.
Right.
So, you know, why have an independently elected...
Can I ask you, Chair, how many votes did that passed by the charter.
It didn't. What do you mean passed by?
I mean, it didn't get approved on vote, did it?
No, it's the, in the process. It's a draft.
The committee is working step by step and to make changes, and they seem to be all on the same page. And Ken and I went to one of the first public sessions about it, and I think we're in agreement that.
Well, very few of our suggestions,
none of them,
or maybe none of them that were voiced at that point have made it into the draft.
Can I ask him what was the reason for the change of why they wanted to make these changes? I don't see it listed in the email. I just
because
see the recommendation.
You have to read between the lines.
Yeah, the public about the charters were and what I believe is that the schools that are public schools are going to be hit the most by the charters.
No, by law, the school's protected rather well.
Yeah, but
they won't be there. It's the really the three elected boards that have staff that really works at it, which is town planner, library director, parks and rec director, board of health agent, and conservation commission. Conservation is an appointed board, but they. How do they do their job if they don't have say as to who,
Well, that was my question, why they were trying to change that to a different structure. I don't see it.
The idea is that they want more central control with the town manager, but why I disagree is that we're in a town board, we're elected town board, you're even conservation is appointed. We hire town planner. Town planner is Elaine, and she's grown her responsibilities, and she has the department that she runs, the land use and planning. And in our case, she's hired Jennifer, and which is kind of a change for us, but because we've grown as a town, and Jennifer is the principal planner, and Jennifer
doing a great job
works with us and does a great job. Works with us, and she reports to Elaine. Part of Elaine reports to us, and over the years we haven't participated in
getting involved.
We've been reduced by what's been going on with Town Hall, and really our role is part of Elaine's salary comes from our budget, from our funds that people pay into the process, and we should have a say in the town planner as a position that works reports to us. Just as conservation has their conservation agent, Don McAdam, as I mentioned a lot today, and the health agent and all the town departments have their professionals. And another concern is the town clerk position they want to make appointed instead of elected. And it's taking power from the people and putting it into the town manager.
To the appointment aspect of it.
And there's been unfairness in that process over the years, and it's just better if the people elect straight up.
Right.
I've been an appointed person here on this board as well, and an elected person on this board, and I appreciate that both things can happen. But if it's an elected environment,
very good explanation.
We should have. Who are, Ken mentioned, and if you don't mind me repeating what you said, at some point it would be nice to move Jennifer into the position of town planner and, going through all the process that we need to go through. And that seems to be the direction we're going in someday, but if they take that out of our hands, we have no control over it, and that's not.
It should be an elected position.
It should be up to the elected officials.
Yeah, it needs to be. Otherwise,
Right.
I mean, it was so bad when I was doing the DPW that they never published. They had a woman take the notes, but we never got minutes. There wasn't enough time to get the minutes together. Mm-hmm. I mean, we just couldn't do what you were trying to do.
Couldn't follow anything.
I mean, it's very frustrating. I mean, if you go back to Management 101, in every one of your organizational classes, you know, responsibility and authority go hand in hand. And right now, the new proposal charter change does not do that, in my opinion.
So, Mr. Chairman, what actions can you take out of this order?
Well, I'm planning to go to the next open hearing, whatever date it is.
Wednesday.
Wednesday at
7 p.m. Yep. And I wanted to speak for the board, but I will speak for myself for sure, but it comes more important if I say I'm speaking for the board, and that's why I put it on the agenda.
I would like to motion that the board supports Ken going to this meeting and keeping the town planner position reporting to the planning board. As an example, that keep it succinct, my motion is that we support Ken as a board keeping the town planner position reporting the planning board.
I second.
Okay. Yep. Motion's on the floor. Further discussion, because I know I want to get out of here. Mm-hmm. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Anyone abstained? Motion carries.
Okay.
Good luck.
And okay, good luck. Real quick. last item is, I think, unless
we'll there's...
approve the minutes for October
24th. I make a motion, yes?
Yeah, go ahead.
I make a motion to approve. Yes, please, thank you. The minutes as stated.
Do I hear a second?
Second.
Okay, further discussion? Seeing none, how do you vote?
Aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Anyone abstained? Motion carries.
I have to abstain because I...
Okay.
I like the cartoon.
yeah, I know you use it as your Facebook page.
If there's any other liaison reports or whatever, or future agenda items, let me know. We've got a relatively light schedule for this next meeting, right?
Nothing right now.
we're not going to encourage it, but we'll let you know whether we can get out of here without it. Entertain a motion to adjourn.
So move.
Second.
So
move.
Yeah. All those in favor of adjourning, say aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Anyone abstain? Motion carries. Thank you all for staying.
Thank you, Buck.
Thank you.
Thanks for running it.